Before we get started, I want to say True Vanguard was going to be on the show today. He was in the Skype call. We were ready to go. And then our Comcast overlords had other plans for him tonight. So
they ruined Friday and they ruined Thursday.
Yeah, we couldn't even stream this Friday because both of us were lagging due to Comcast.
Oh, really? That's too bad.
No stopping. Fantastic. Although they fixed mine really quickly, so I can't.
That's good. Yeah. Man, what? Comcast? Come on now.
It was the painters, by the way. The painters? They knocked some wiring.
Oh, really?
Brilliant.
So there's an actual outside hardware that got wrecked. That sucks.
I hate the painters.
Can't really
they were here for like a
Comcast.
Week and a half being loud.
Nah, you can blame
so I couldn't record videos. And then they knocked out my internet.
Oh, my God.
Worst
did you?
Ever.
You should file a complaint.
Yeah.
Wait, were they painting your house or place or something else?
They were painting the entire apartments, and they were outside my window for like 2 weeks.
Oh, my God.
It was. Just imagine a lawnmower engine outside your window, and then that coming in through the stream.
They had like a compressor outside there?
Yeah.
Oh,
they just set up shop outside Watts's window and didn't move at all for. Because like you were playing with me one day, and I was like, oh my God, what is that noise? And then 2 days later, it was still there. It's like, how long does it take for you to paint this shit? At least move the compressor.
I would have gone out there and told him, look, you guys got to move. I work from my house. I need some peace and quiet. You got to go.
Yeah. I would have pulled that card too. And then I would have pulled out the universal remote.
Uh-huh.
I guess that's kind of a bad thing to say.
Yeah, I'm that implies a
gun. Fine.
That implies I'm going to shoot him.
Unless you're sitting there with a remote control, just
an actual universal remote control.
All right. Oh, man. Well, hello and welcome to the 84th Planet Destiny podcast. We got stuff to talk about this week. It's Gamescom. Yeah. It was Gamescom week. There's been a lot of stuff that they actually talked about. Watts and I can finally say, hey, sorry we were gone that week. We were at Bungie playing Rise of Iron. Sorry for the deception, but they wanted to keep that under wraps so we can actually talk about all the cool stuff that we played while we were there. And one more thing before we truly, truly get started. We were going to have True Vanguard on tonight. Internet, Comcast had other issues. But everyone, please congratulate him and his wife on their beautiful new baby daughter. They just... when did they? Yeah.
Not long ago.
I think it was
last week,
Monday.
Right?
Yeah, I think it was like less than a week ago, I feel like.
Yeah, less than a week ago. Yeah,
definitely.
So...
seems terrifying.
It's a fantastic week. We got new babies, and then we got new Destiny info.
That's right.
Destiny info. Not all of it is good, but some of it is great.
True. Should we just get it? Rip the Band-Aid?
You want to start?
Try
with
the match, baby. Woo!
The way they dropped the news, I yelled at Irk. He was just like, "Yeah, we've got like new strikes, new raid. We got a new Crucible game mode, private matches." I'm like. What did he just
private,
say? Why?
Private
we can't
matches.
Do that.
You think we wouldn't notice?
Right?
Yeah.
Dude, private matches is huge. This is like amazing news. It changes the landscape of Destiny for just about every player. We're gonna start seeing tournaments. MLG already tweeted that they're gonna start doing game battles for Destiny.
Signups are already there for it. Like you can go to their website and start signing up for that stuff.
Yep. Every streamer is gonna start doing some kind of fun with this, right? It's like it's just too tempting not to bring in people and do some kind of ridiculousness with it, whether you actually get competitive with it. Where you decide to have six people on Sparrows and one person with a rocket launcher trying not to get run over. You know, whatever it be, there's going to be fun to be had here. This is amazing news.
Testing. Like,
weapon testing.
Weapon testing. Machinima.
Yeah, all of the, like, map guides that can be done now.
Oh,
like,
yeah. Map guides are going to be great.
It's going to be beautiful because people can make some really crazy stuff, especially with that artifact with the special camera lenses.
Yes. The cinema artifact,
nothing that got released today or this week. There is one big piece of info that we want to kind of get into before we start talking about all the other awesome stuff that happened. There's one kind of big turd.
A Debbie Downer.
Yeah, there's one big turd, but we can get that out of the way so we can have a fun podcast. So it looks like the PlayStation exclusives from Taken King, so Jade Rabbit, the Strike, all the like the PlayStation exclusive armor.
Zen Meteor.
Zen Meteor.
Sector 618.
Sector 618. That map.
That you're happy about.
Be happy about it. Yep.
You're not getting that. There's a good side to that because we're not going to be able to experience it on Trials.
You're right. Oh my God.
Whew. So basically, all that stuff. It looks like that's not going to be coming to Xbox.
When? Not until year three.
Not until
year three or after.
Wait, or they after. Said
that Sony is using about it.
Wait, they said year three or after?
No. Well, yeah. I'm sorry. They said
fall of 2017.
Yeah, they said fall of 2017 or after.
Yeah. Wow, that's weird that they added an or after.
Right.
Yeah. Well, they're covering their bases because the original statement was like you can get this stuff for Xbox as early as whatever.
Fall of 2016.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I gotta give a shout out to TH Connor who's in chat right now. I'm pretty sure he broke this story. If he didn't, man, he was early on it because he put up a Reddit post that pretty much confirmed this by comparing the fine print and the, you know, what they were offering with the collector's edition, or not the collector's edition, the complete edition of Destiny, comparing what was in the PlayStation exclusives in that advertising and what was in the PlayStation exclusives in the Rise of Iron advertising, he was basically able to come up with what exactly was not coming to the Xbox One. He posted that up on Reddit this morning, and about 4 hours later, like every news gaming news site that was at Gamescom seemed to have asked Bungie about it directly and confirmed it. So big ups to TH Connor there.
Yeah,
Connor knocking one out. Let's go. But
this is horrible news. This is really bad.
It's not good.
There's a lot of implications behind it too, because like for instance, the fact that Destiny 2 is assumed that it's going to be coming out at least by fall of 2017. So these exclusives, are they coming to Destiny 2, which means that our whole arsenal is going to be brought over, you know what I mean, into Destiny 2, or is it literally the content is just going to be like, well, you can go use the Zen Meteor on Xbox now, but we've moved on to Destiny 2. Like, that's awful.
Yeah.
There's, I don't know, it's really weird. We also don't know how Destiny 2 is going to be. If it's going to be a whole new game, it's going to be just an unbelievably large expansion. I don't know. I don't think you can find a single person out there who truly is like, yeah, no, exclusives are fine. They're great. There's nothing wrong with them, especially in this case. I'm pretty sure everyone out there, you know, aside from the people who are getting paid for this, are like, man, there's no one out there that's actually genuinely supportive of exclusives that are this long, a whole year, and now 2 years, I guess.
A two-year exclusive is ridiculous.
Best case scenario would be that maybe exotics go over to Destiny 2, but nothing else, so it is kind of a fresh start.
That's a good point.
I could believe that, because then they still get to use it, but we're kind of starting fresh. I mean, worst case, you never get to use it, or it's just an expansion and not a whole new game like we thought it was.
Yeah.
Right.
So. Yeah, I mean, they're from what I've seen, every time somebody describes it, it is a game, right? It's the next game. It's Destiny 2, the next game.
It is, So that's how it's always been.
Shocked if all the exotics moved over. I'd be pretty surprised.
I mean, I just don't want it to be Thorn, Last Word, Mighta Multitool, Hawkmoon. Right. You know what I mean?
I want a brand new start. You know, I want us to go through that again, discovering what the really good weapons are and finding things, and I want to experience that again. I don't want to have the same stuff, looking at the same things.
Seriously, again. Yeah, it needs a fresh redo. So it does make me very nervous. You are right, though. At the very worst case scenario, it could be that Xbox just doesn't get to experience Jade Rabbit and Zen Meter and that strike realistically during a time that it meant something. It's not,
And there's, you know, there's not the worst another thing, new but... PvP map too, Icarus.
Right.
You know, that's probably not going to come. The quest lines as well from the Taken King and from Rise of Iron that are PlayStation exclusive, they're not going to come. The armor is not going to come. I think that includes the PlayStation specific exclusive Iron Banner armor.
And is that ever going to come though?
I don't think it is. I mean, they advertise it on the PlayStation website as being exclusive to PlayStation.
Yeah, no.
Yeah, I thought those were specific to that system.
No, if it's exclusive to PlayStation, then it's part of this deal.
It's not coming. Yeah.
Oh.
Not in your three anyway.
Oh, I'm sorry. Actually, what I was thinking is that I didn't expect the Iron Banner exclusives to be ones that are going to come to Xbox. Nope, I thought that was actually just something. Yeah.
Also, the Sublime gear, not coming. That's something that, you know, looked pretty cool in a couple of cases. I know that the Neurogas armor I thought looked phenomenal. Also, I think it's called Barkham Dune on the Warlock. That looked really good. Mm-hmm. Like, some of that looked really nice. And, you know, Xbox users just not get a chance to experience that because of this exclusivity deal. And I don't understand why it's been extended by another year. Like, that's something I think we should think about a little bit, too.
Money.
Well, is it money, though?
Is it money, seems or like is it misplanning. They didn't have enough exclusives for the Rise of Iron to make exclusives?
So, I think it's... So, there was an Edge article, or Edge issue that came out today, and they had a lot of really good stuff in it. And in there, we finally got confirmation that Destiny 2 was meant to launch this fall.
Yep.
And it was pushed back to fall of 2017. So, my theory is that the like the PlayStation exclusives that were in Taken King, it wasn't contracted based on length of time, as in a year. It was contracted for in between releases. Mm-hmm. So it would be like, these will be PlayStation exclusives until Destiny 2 comes out. And then when that got pushed back and Rise of Iron came out, those exclusives, due to the way the contract stated, probably got extended out into Destiny 2.
That would make a lot of sense.
That would also talk toward why we saw all those exotics in the database that never got released. Mm-hmm. You know, at some point, they might have been planned releases for The Taken King, and then once they realized that Destiny 2 did get delayed, they decided to hold back on them so they wouldn't have to develop more for The Rise of Iron.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, if you think about it, it's pretty crazy that it wasn't that long ago that the news of it getting pushed back was.
Right.
And people in the studio didn't know that it had got delayed until when we found out. So they made Rise of Iron in a very short time. So on the positive side of all of this, they've come up with some pretty fantastic stuff in that short amount of time.
Yeah, you are right. Which also means, well, so my theory also with the release schedule as well, because of the collection coming out, they're releasing the collection bundle, which is going to be all the expansions and vanilla Destiny. It seems like this also confirms the fact that Rise of Iron is going to be what we have for a whole year. Because do you think they release another expansion after they have the collection?
I don't think it'll be another expansion, no. I think what we could expect to see maybe some like deeper live events, like maybe they do something a little bit more extensive than what we've had, and just like dropping exotics throughout the time span of Rise of Iron.
I think you're right, Watts. I think we'll see them similar to what happened with Festival of the Lost last year. It was a slightly deeper thing than it was the year before. I think they'll continue to add upon it for this year. Same with SRL. We've already heard that there's going to be a new PvE twist to SRL and more maps. I don't know about Crimson Doubles. I don't really know what you can do with that to make it deeper. Maybe add some PvE stuff to it. And then hopefully we get another April update type of thing. But I certainly am not expecting another expansion in 2017 until Destiny 2 comes out.
Yeah, I mean, it just... The news lays it out and confirms that, well, we have Rise of Iron, and then that Edge article is saying that's been pushed to 2017 for Destiny 2. And also, it really does concern me that these exclusives are going to be exclusive until then, which sounds like they're going to then bring them forward. I mean, that's a strike also. So,
is going to be available
in Destiny 2?
It might just unlock in Destiny, and then, you know, if you still want to play Destiny, Xbox players can now play with Zen Meteor and Jade Rabbit, but Destiny 2 is going to be, you know, a break.
I mean,
I think I don't ultimately want to either. What I believe is going to happen is that they're not going to really have time with those exotic exclusives.
That's how I see it, too.
And especially not the strike. Like, they're not going to bring a strike forward. That wouldn't make any sense.
Okay, so I think we need to brace ourselves for them bringing content forward in Destiny 2 if some of this is being presented this way.
Like, contractually, they're like obligated to bring it forward as part of whatever. But yeah. Yeah.
Can we get... I mean...
Where did you hear that?
I didn't hear that from anywhere. I'm just thinking this, like, if it states in the contract this is PlayStation exclusive until this date, that gives some expectation to people that aren't on PlayStation that they will be getting this content that, you know, they paid the same price for. I don't know. Maybe I'm looking too much into it.
I think from now on, when we look at Destiny's PlayStation exclusive content, we need to look at it as almost a permanent PlayStation exclusive until we're told otherwise.
Yeah.
Which is unfortunate. I mean, I thought that Xbox users got fucked last time when the Hawkmoon got nerfed right before they got it. But that's nothing compared to this. You know,
yeah, frankly, this
as
is
an
bad.
Xbox user, I'd be super pissed off. And as a PlayStation user, I'm still pissed off because it means, you know, some of those Sector 618 can never be in Iron Banner, can never be in Trials, which
I'm okay
know,
with that.
Yeah.
I'm fucking okay with that.
But Jade Rabbit and Zen Meteor can never be sold by Xur. You know, it's got a lot of meaning to
it. Yeah, you're right.
So
didn't think about that.
It stinks. It stinks.
Yeah.
It's just bad. It's a bad scenario. It makes the community salty.
Yeah.
You know, there's enough things in the game right now that make the community salty. We don't need another thing added on top of it. So it's just bitter. And also what it spells for the forecast of Destiny 2. And Destiny 2 is supposed to be a new title. Like Bungie's employees are saying, working on an unannounced title. You know, new title from Bungie. So that it is supposed to be a new SKU, a new release. So I don't want to play a new Destiny 2 that's like, oh, yeah, it's all this other stuff that was there.
Yeah,
it's new.
Strikes. Yeah, that would be too bad. Okay. I mean, the Edge article, I don't know if you guys want to go into our Edge article or save it till last.
There's still a lot of stuff that like we can go.
Yeah, the Edge article does seem to imply that Destiny 2 is going to be a new game and that Luke Smith is working on it right now.
Yeah, I didn't read the article, so I don't know those details.
Yeah. All right. So that was the bad. You want to talk about the good?
Well, yeah, we have one like small piece of good info that we can get out of the way. Breyer, I guess, you know, they watched the podcast last week and saw your genuine anger towards the fact that they weren't going to update Vault Space, or at least that's what they reported. Like, good God, Breyer was just seething.
Livid.
Yeah.
Livid. I was sitting there going,
I suggest you watch that clip.
Is he serious? Is he like actually angry? I kind of want to like leave the room right now. Oh my God.
Yeah.
So yeah, Breyer got angry at Vault Space last week and how it wasn't being updated. And then like today, one of the other big stories has been they're working on it. They're doing stuff. It won't come right when like the game launches, but it's happening, planning things.
This is great news. We don't know if it's going to come 2 weeks after Rise of Iron. We don't know if it's going to come 2 months after Rise of Iron. But just knowing that that's in the future means that, you know, that relief is coming, right? So maybe I don't delete all my Vault of Glass weapons. You know, maybe I just deal with a few inventory slots and a lot of management for a little while, knowing that that relief is coming. To me, this shows that Destiny does listen to the community. This is amazing. You know, people were upset about this, including me, and they responded to it, and that's great.
So they're staggering the vault increase, but so they said they were no, like, okay, it's not happening.
They're doing something.
They're not staggering it. They're just like they have more important shit to work on right now.
They didn't do anything about Vault Space. They found out that people were really upset about it, and they said, okay, we'll do something about Vault Space.
Huh. Yeah. All right. That's good. It's good news. It just sounds like it's going to come in like October.
It could probably when, like, be like Festival of the Lost time period. That
But it's coming.
Yeah. Be like, okay, I know you're pissed off about this. And how about we give it to you sometime down the road? Like, all right, cool. Great.
I
don't know. Yeah, at least it's coming. At least it's coming. Yeah. At least they acknowledged it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You guys want to talk about private matches and your experience with them?
Yeah, you guys got to play it, right?
Yeah.
We got to actually play it.
My goodness.
We only got to play Supremacy. We didn't like we didn't get to go in and try out a bunch of different game modes and everything and get too crazy with it. We got to play Supremacy. It was really nice to just be able to like swap teams instead of like having to join this other new fire team, yada yada. Just
You can do it in game too. You can switch teams, so that's really
You can switch teams in game.
Oh, that's so
cool. You can play like Infected. You could legitimately do Infected.
I was wondering that. I'm glad you said Watts. I was wondering that.
That is so cool.
Yeah.
When you guys were there, it wouldn't let you do fire teams larger than three for... Oh, wait. You said you didn't get to check it out, right?
We didn't get to check that out. There's been a lot of misinformation about that.
Yeah.
Yeah. What's the final word right now about that? Like, can you do elimination 6v6? Yeah, is it possible?
The final word is you can do 6v6 elimination. You can do you can do 4v4 elimination. You can do 4v4 skirmish.
You can do 6v6 salvage and basically play hardpoint. It'll be crazy.
That's awesome.
But maybe really fun.
Yeah. It should be interesting what people come up with. When we were there, we were told you couldn't go larger than what the current playlist offered, so you couldn't do 4v whatever for salvage. But I guess during the time that we were there, changed that.
That's smart.
There's other options there too, like on vehicles that allow it. You can change whether it happens in the morning or at night or during the daytime. You can you can add vehicles to maps that support it.
You can turn light levels on and off, which will be really fun. I think that could be an interesting game mode, make one person at max light level, then make everyone else put on shitty white armor with no light level.
That'd be fun. Like a raid boss PvP thing. Basically. That'd be awesome.
Yeah, my thought is Juggernaut mode would be 1v6. The person who has won has max level light gear, and then the other team is light level 170, or taking stuff from the raid, and then the Juggernaut person can only use shotguns or a universal remote.
Nice.
Wouldn't that be fun? But it would be elimination. It'd be elimination. So
that'd be fun.
So they have to get reses on their buddies. From whoever is Juggernaut.
I love it. Those 170 guys wouldn't be able to get a one-shot kill with a sniper rifle either.
No, they'd have to team shot. Yeah. That'd be a fun game mode.
The one thing that we do know as far as restrictions go, you can't have a seven. You cannot have a 7v5 or whatever. You can't go.
Can't go more than six on a team.
Can't go more than six of the team.
Yeah. You'd break.
Yeah, this sounds mega fun, man. I can't wait to get started with this. Yep. I also really, I mentioned it earlier, but I really am looking forward to seeing some real tournaments happen. You know, we've seen tournaments happen in Destiny and they're fun, but the fact that you're constantly waiting for the matchmaking to work really does break up the flow of a tournament, and it makes it hard to watch at times. So now people who put together tournaments can put together a tournament and these things can actually happen and be watchable. We can start hoping, or the tournament guys especially can start hoping for a spectator mode so that they could actually spectate these things in a fairly watchable way. But this is a huge start. This really does put competitive Destiny in a light,
I'm really excited.
The fact that MLG is looking at it is great news.
Mm-hmm. It can get a MLG lot more structured. It can get way more structured than it is with people attempting to get into those same lobby as each other, and it breaks it up. You can have people coming in with commentators, and it's just going to be presented in a much more accessible way. Yeah. People are going to see it and be like, this is really fun. I want to watch it, because watching Destiny is fun. Mm-hmm. I really do think it's a fun game to watch. So it's just going to bring more people to the scene.
Yeah, I'm excited to see really good players play against each other. Is also really fun, because
hopefully down the road, in a private match, you can set yourself to a spectator mode in there. They're a spectator option, and we could actually get proper coverage.
Yeah, I just mentioned that. That would make watching a tournament much better. Especially what they've done with Call of Duty, where they have a specific spectator mode with an overhead view where it shows everybody and, it shows everybody's score and that kind of stuff would be awesome. I wouldn't expect that till Destiny 2 or beyond, but just getting private matches is really a great start.
Yeah. I mean, whatever technology they use, to be able to get those cuts or those shots. You know how they like have people running in, dropping a super, and it's clearly a spectator mode. They just need to take that code and put it in the game so we can have that. So you just like, you can flip your team from Alpha Bravo Spectator. You know, that'd be great.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Yeah. Can't wait. So
private matches.
Supremacy.
They're gonna be awesome.
So, yeah, Supremacy was super fun.
I can't wait to play it.
Yeah,
it looks so cool.
A fun game mode. It's so fun.
Yeah, so Supremacy was immediately when I like first sat down to start playing and like we loaded into the game. My first game was just trash. I don't think I actually I recorded the game, but I didn't use any of the footage because I forgot to upgrade my subclasses and armor. So I was like, I was running around there with like the base level jump and then nothing else, which is really difficult when people are popping supers. And in the second match, I was fine. But yeah, no, that quickly became Supremacy quickly became one of my favorite game modes just due to its clash, which I've slowly begun to like a lot more, actually. Every single fight. The objective is just always moving with having to pick up crests. Maybe you're trying to stop the enemy team from getting points by picking up your team's crests, or maybe you're trying to, you know, go get a couple crests that dropped, a little further ways away. Like, it's a really interesting game mode for Destiny specifically.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's really fast paced too. You respawn a lot faster. Mm-hmm. You're obviously getting supers faster just because kills give you super energy, but also picking up the tag does.
Yeah, that was crazy watching the footage.
Picking up tags give you super?
Yeah, picking up tags gives it gives you the equivalent of like a orb of light. It's kinda crazy.
But they did say they were looking at shooting that down a little bit.
Yeah.
Because it was a little bit too hectic.
Is it mayhemy?
It was pretty mayhemy. Like
they said, they wanted to be somewhere between control and mayhem, and it was a little too close to mayhem. So they want to dial it down a little bit.
An orb of light on every crest—that is a lot.
It's like one of the small orbs of light. So it gives you a noticeable bump, but it's not like huge amount. And that's one of the things that's awesome is. Even if you're not doing well, like you're not landing kills, you can just run around and like pick up crests and you're going to gain super energy from that. And then you can get some kills off that once you get your super. Yeah.
Of course.
I used to play a ton of Kill Confirmed in Call of Duty in Black Ops 2, I think it was introduced, if I'm not crazy. And it quickly became my favorite game mode.
Yeah.
So I'm really excited to see it come to Destiny. I think it fits Destiny's play style perfectly too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, same here. Every time I play, if I do load up Call of Duty, usually Kill Confirmed is the playlist that I want to go to if there's enough people in it.
Same.
Yeah. It's a lot of fun. So I'm super excited to play it in Destiny. I feel like it's going to be the new Control for me, where I'm like, I'd prefer playing Supremacy if it's available instead of Control for me.
Yeah, I agree.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Supremacy is probably what I'm going to be doing now for... I need to log in and, you know, play some games, maybe stream a little bit. Supremacy.
Yeah.
Hopefully they make it a permanent playlist.
Oh, I'm pretty sure.
I'm sure they will.
Same way Rift was made a permanent playlist.
Right. Nice.
Yeah. What else? Oh, we can talk about the maps that we played on.
Yep.
Did you guys play on all four?
No, we only played
two. No, just two.
Which two? Unfortunately.
We played the PlayStation exclusive one, Icarus.
Floating Gardens.
Because Icarus is actually a really good map. The first thing people said about it, they're like, hey, Holtz, they said there's doors on Icarus.
There's like one door, right?
Because
it's like this middle section that no one really uses, and there's doors there.
I was looking for a CD.
Did I read it correctly? You can die from the door? Can you get crushed in there?
I have no
idea. Or is that incorrect?
So imagine just the map is a large circle, and at the very center, like this small little area, there's a small tunnel that connects like an inner ring from one side to the other.
Yeah.
So you can either go through that tunnel or you can just walk around.
Walk around.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's basically the center of the map is a massive trap and you shouldn't go there because there's about 20 ways to get into the center of the map. Less than quarters.
This is the one that's like the Vex Shrine, right?
No, that's the Vex Shrine one. This is the one
on Floating Gardens.
Okay.
This is the one on
Mercury.
But I think Icarus was my favorite of the two. Yeah. It just felt like there was a little bit more action, and there was a little bit more like different places you could go, different ways you could get to areas. It felt like snipers were doing just as well as shotgunners by sticking to the outside. So yeah, Icarus could potentially be like our best PlayStation exclusive map.
No, it's the first PlayStation exclusive map where I'm not immediately like, oh god, this map again. Like I actually I think I'll enjoy it for a little while. I like the Vex one more personally though. It's the first time they've done like a three lane map, but it's not obviously a three lane map because they didn't make it just like, let's make a rectangle. And now there's one, two, three lanes and some ways to connect them. It's like, it's almost a circle like this. And then one lane takes a long way. There's another short lane right here. And there's a really short lane on the, far side of the circle. I really, really enjoyed that particular map. There, all the radial structures in there made for a lot of really cool movement options. There's actually a lot of levels to the map too, so
there's
you get some good vertical gameplay in there.
I thought I was gonna die when I fell off into the water. I was like, oh no, this is probably a death place. I'm like, oh, it's fine, just cool. I can go this way.
I liked the Vex one a lot more. We got to try out a bunch of weapons too. Exotics.
Hold up, before we talk about the weapons, did the maps look visually upgraded? Because from the footage, it felt like I don't know if it was just because it was new and I'm excited to see new stuff. It felt like it was looking even better.
I really can't remember. I can't tell graphical upgrades based on when we play because it's a different monitor.
Okay,
that's true,
gotcha.
Yeah,
different monitor. And then, of course, I recorded on the lowest possible quality footage.
RIP.
Yeah, my bad. Forgot to set the Elgato from 1 to 10 on the quality slider. Yeah. Didn't take up much space on my hard drive, though.
Man, these videos are so compressed. Wow.
Yeah, amazing. I was like, wow, this only takes up like 7 gigs. This is great. Oh. Oops.
Yeah, because on those videos, when I was looking at them, they just seem graphically maybe another step. And I don't know if it's because, again, if it's new and I have the rose colored glasses on, or if there really is maybe some refinement to the engine or the visuals that they were able to do.
I don't know, I'll see if I can get some sort of confirmation on it, but I don't think there was really any substantial upgrade to it as far as I'm aware.
Right. Well, I'm not expecting like
60 FPS or anything like that.
Yeah, not like that.
It's like snowing all the time and raining is like dry.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Textures.
Textures and lighting.
A little better. Mm-hmm.
That's what it looked like. Just lighting and textures maybe were a little more high fidelity in comparison to previous maps. And I was like, nice. I like that.
I can kind of see that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Weapons.
So for weapons, if you'll notice in the footage on the Planet Destiny channel, Holtz is using a shotgun.
I'm also using a shotgun.
Yeah, I think everyone.
How about
was
that?
Using a shotgun. Everyone besides except Inkooch was. Yeah, Inkooch was the only one that was using a sniper. Yeah. There. the shotgun that we had was basically a god roll matador.
It was amazing. I was like, this is the best shotgun that I've used since Fell Winters went away.
Yeah.
Whoa.
It's really good.
It was good.
Yeah. What was the name?
I don't remember.
It's Last Ditch. I think Last.
Was it, or was it Occam's Razor?
Is it the Orbit?
No.
Dead Orbit one?
It's the
that
dead
they
orbit
were showing?
It was the Dead Orbit one, yeah.
Oh, man. That thing.
It was
dump in some moats to get some Dead Orbit.
Yeah, it was
hell yeah.
Make sure
I'm
my,
interested.
Dead Orbit guy is edged up nice.
And all of, I think all of ours had like the same roll, too. It was a max range roll with like smooth ballistics, rangefinder rifled barrel, something like that. Yeah. So it was nice. Nasty.
It was like it was just the best shotgun you can probably find.
Yeah.
Nice.
So good.
The Mida multi-tool archetype of scout rifle is coming back for legendaries. The one that we all had was Mida archetype. In the footage it says it has 10 rounds in the mag, but that's cuz I was using brace frame. Which reduces the mag size for a big stability bump, which was worth it, in my opinion, on that one. Anyway.
Is that the one that looked a little bit like not like the others?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
It was
really
kind of
good.
A reskin one.
It was a solid scout rifle.
Mm-hmm.
I think a lot of people started realizing that it was really good because gradually as you got on, more and more people started picking up the scout rifle.
Nice.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah. The auto rifle was pretty cool too. I think that was like the Dead Orbit auto rifle.
Looked like Dead Orbit.
It was. Yeah. Dead Orbit.
Yeah. Yeah. The auto rifle was pretty good.
It looked like it had a lot of stability, especially considering
it had rodeo.
From the lot of the footage I was watching, people didn't have any perks filled out, so
It had rodeo on it, so that's why it looked like it had stability, because rodeo.
Well, a lot of the European guys, the guys who were playing over in Gamescom, they don't have any of the perks filled out, and it still looked pretty usable.
Yeah, it was good. The
Future War called the whale.
No,
I was underwhelmed by that hand cannon.
Well, yeah. For starters, that hand cannon was in like the faster rate of fire archetype of hand cannon. Mm. Yeah.
I used it for a little bit and was like, no, I can't kill anything. I don't want to do this.
Yeah.
The pulse rifle was my favorite.
I couldn't get used to that pulse rifle. I think it's like the stability on it or something. I
loved it.
It jumped up and down quite a bit, even for it to have a pretty substantial stability roll on it. So maybe pulses are getting some sort of rework.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it definitely seemed like there was more recoil than we were used to. Mm-hmm. For me, pulse rifle was the most consistent thing for me. Pulse and scout felt really good. I think the pulse is the crucible one.
It had a weird paint scheme on it, so we'll just say, yeah, it probably was the crucible one.
Yeah, it's the crucible one.
And of course, all this stuff could change too that we're talking about because early build. Because of that hand cannon.
The shotgun, no, stop it.
Yeah, that hand cannon was like fastest rate of fire archetype 7 in the mag. It was basically a Deadly You Don't 2.0. It was bad.
Wow.
it's pretty rough.
No thanks.
Yeah. Yeah. No thanks. But I think that's basically it as far as PvP stuff that we got to experience while we were there.
We got to personally mess around with artifacts. That's the only other thing.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, the artifacts were really cool.
The one I went to first was getting rid of your super for extra grenade and melee. Because as a Night Stalker, I was like, I don't need a super. So it definitely makes your neutral game, like, the best. You become into a neutral game god. What I did notice, though, because it was Supremacy and you get your supers very quickly, I regretted not having my bow to get rid of them. Especially as the first match we were playing against, like, 20 Hammer Titans.
Yeah.
There was five Titans? I think four Hammer Titans.
We were against five Hammer Titans and then Enkucha's Blade Dancer.
It was the worst thing ever. I was like, there's constant hammers. So I definitely wish I had my bow to shut that down.
Yeah.
But it was definitely cool having two melee, two grenades. The other one that I used was the one that highlights when someone's low or when they have a super.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think it's as game-changing as people initially thought it would be, because a lot of people thought it might highlight behind walls, which would be crazy.
Oh yeah, no
that
way.
Would be terrible. That would be awful. But yeah, I mean, it's instead of having to look when someone like look closely to see if someone has a super, you can just see it, which is kind of nice. It also allows you to prioritize targets a little bit better. So like we said before, it's going to be good when you're like carrying people in trials because they can see when someone has a super, or you can see it and you can call it out. So. Yeah, I think it'd be good.
How obvious is the outline? Like when somebody was red, is it very obvious? Because on the compressed footage, it's a little difficult because it's compressed. You know, it's not clear video. But like, it was the yellow when their super is ready.
Yeah,
like they have a shimmer.
Yeah, no, it was like a yellow outline.
Outline, literally.
It's very, very obvious.
Yeah.
Cool.
I messed around with the radar one.
Yeah, I did.
Yeah, the radar one was perfect because in year one I used to always use Knucklehead as my exotic until the Bones of AO came out, and then those have just never really left me. But yeah, the Knucklehead, fantastic perk, and when you're trying to learn a new map, the radar one really really good. Yeah.
One thing we should also talk about is the one that gives you extra melee and extra grenade does not stack with armor.
Okay.
Do
we have actual confirmation on that?
Yeah, it was on Twitter. Okay. Gatto asked Mr. Fruit to go and ask someone at Bungie because he's at Gamescom. He was like, can we finally just settle this? Because Mr. Fruit was told something, and we were told something totally different.
And it's been, like, just back and forth, back and forth.
They're like, but Mr. Fruit said this. And it's like, but Dado said this. And it's just, like, back and forth of misinformation. Yeah. So we did get Mr. Fruit to go and ask someone at Bungie if it stacks. And they said, no, it is not.
No stacks. You cannot have three grenades. Sorry.
You cannot have three warlock melees. No.
Sorry.
Stop it. It's not allowed.
Thank the baby Jesus.
I don't want to experience that.
You know, it's going to be interesting for the Fun Police build. So you have two suppressor nades and then two force barriers being able to proc every time.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, you're not going to have your bubble, which is kind of synonymous with that, being able to pop a bubble and say B. But, you know, if you're playing Supremacy and you're just shutting down supers with grenades, they'll be interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so the artifact should be really cool. The other artifact that we got to try out in PvE was the mind control.
If you look at my gameplay of the strike, it's literally me just meleeing things.
Yeah. Basically, Mesa, Sean, Watts, and I, we were on a fire team for the new strike. We won't give any spoilers of the actual strike because I know a lot of people want to just experience that. But what we were doing is we were just running around meleeing all the things.
Trying to make an army.
Yeah.
Could you, as a single player, melee more than one guy? Can you control more than one guy at a time?
You can only do one at a time. It's a pretty low proc rate as well. It was like maybe 20% of your melees.
Oh, it's a chance.
Yeah, it's a chance. It's not a guaranteed thing.
Did it matter if it was a charged melee or not?
No, it didn't matter.
Yeah.
No, didn't matter at all.
Got ourselves a captain.
Yeah, we got a captain. We got a servitor. We got a vandal, the invisible vandal. We were basically playing Pokemon, but with this. we had to catch all the things.
The captain was my favorite. He was just standing there, and I was looking at him and waving at him, and then he was like, let's go! He just ran. He just took off. He was leading the pack.
both the vandal and the captain just did. They were not afraid of anything, and they just went in. The servitor was really disappointing because it likes to just hang out in its one little area, and it didn't want to follow us and go, you know, kill stuff with us.
How did the other enemies react to it? Did they treat him as one of you guys, or did they prioritize fire on you?
I think in the build that we were playing was really early. So some of the enemies, like, I felt like they weren't responding as quickly as they could have. Or maybe it was because it was the lowest level version of the strike. I don't know.
Yeah.
But, yeah, they responded. Like, they would start attacking that thing first because it ran in. It would usually just run in.
Yeah.
How long did it last, also?
About a minute.
Really? That's a long time. Yeah.
It's a good amount of time. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I was expecting it to be, like, 15, 20 seconds.
No, it lasted a pretty substantial amount of time.
Yeah. That's nice.
Yeah, that's good.
That could really come in handy.
It's a novelty, honestly. Yeah. It's just kind of a novelty. And you can only do it to you can only do it to like tier one level mobs. So if it has a yellow health bar, it's not gonna work.
Not gonna happen. Yeah.
You can't go mind control Randall the Vandal.
It's a good way to like do strike playlists or something and make it a little more fun just by trying to take over things. Yeah.
Seems like it'd be really risky on a Nightfall.
Probably. Yes.
Like if there's a burn for that captain and you run up and you're like, hopefully this works, 1 in 5 chance, and it doesn't, and he like, light switches you or something. Or or you know, shoots you with his gun with whatever burn's got on it.
It's fun. It's fun to mess around with. The bad thing is a lot of times like the thing you melee doesn't have a lot of health anyway, like a drag, so it'll just die. No chance to mind control.
That's a sad time.
How did you mind control a shank?
Don't know.
Just, you mind really control strong a shank?
Yeah.
Just whoa, like, yeah.
He was able to mind control a shank.
It didn't die instantly?
No.
Patrick was yelling at me saying it's not going to work. I'm like, it's going to work, Patrick.
Yeah.
It's going to work.
You can see it in my footage on like the final boss. There's a shank, and I just start shooting at it. And I'm like, wait, what? And that's when I shouted at her. Like, how did you do that? How did it not die?
It's hilarious.
Yeah.
Did when it's turned, obviously you can still shoot at it too, right?
No. It's friendly. All like aim assist turns off on it. You can't.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
you can't damage it?
it's a friendly unit. It's a friendly unit to you. Its name tag turns blue.
Wow, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Turns into a blueberry.
That's a little weird that you can't damage it once you've turned them.
I think you can melee it again to reset it.
When they turn back, you can kill them if they like sucked at their job, or you can keep trying to stab them again to keep them on your side.
Oh, I see. Yeah. Huh. Interesting.
Yeah, if you guys want to go see the new strike and us playing Pokemon with all the with all the mobs in there, go check out Mr. 5000 Watch channel. Go check out the Planet Destiny channel. You can see the strike. If you don't want to spoil it, I completely understand as well. So,
yeah.
Cool. I'd like to play Destiny Go. That'd be fun. Yeah. I want to play. I want to catch them all.
Never watched that video about Destiny Go. I never watched that. what else? What else can you mind control a tier one ogre? There weren't any to test.
Yeah.
But we'll definitely try. We'll definitely try once the
yeah.
You guys want to talk about that Bungie vid doc a little bit?
Yeah. Yeah.
That almost brought me to tears. Not gonna lie, the music.
Yeah.
Like, Bungie puts together some awesome mm-hmm. stuff.
Like, they really do.
I want to buy the
soundtrack. There's a lot of information in
there too.
Yeah,
me too.
Yes.
Like, we got to see a lot of new armor, a lot of new weapons. We saw full sets of Trials gear for all three classes.
Yes.
We saw full sets of Iron Banner gear for all three classes. I think we saw a full set of Iron Banner gear with the million shader on it, too.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
We saw full raid gear on all three classes.
And Iron Lord.
Yeah. We saw a lot of new ornaments. Yeah, did we see a full set of Iron Lord gear for everybody?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. 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 Okay.
Yeah.
I remember the close up of the hunter. That's the first time I had seen the hunter.
Yeah.
Gear, and it looked great. The gauntlets with like there were like kind of these spikes coming off of the knuckles, and
you can see it's like on the hood of the cape too.
Yeah.
Can see fire there. I was like, ooh, it's in the cape. That made me excited.
It is. Yeah. It's really good looking. The Iron Lord gear, I think, is my favorite of all the sets they've shown. It just looks phenomenal with the ornaments. But I really do like that Trials gear with the ornaments. Mm-hmm. That's kind of pink holographic ornament that they have. That looks pretty nice. I wonder if shaders are going to be able to apply to ornaments.
I feel like they're not going to.
No?
Just because when we were looking at the screen of putting in ornaments, I feel like it's just going to be that one color. Maybe they'll introduce more like color selections for it later, but mm-hmm. it doesn't seem like it. But I'm going to be wearing all white and the pink, or all black and the pink. And what really got me excited about the Trials gear for Hunter is it turns the whole cape into like a hologram.
Mm-hmm. Oh, really?
I didn't realize that.
Yeah,
that's cool.
Yeah,
it looks awesome.
It looks so good. You see some screenshots where the Hunter's in action, like running, and you can just see this like see-through cape. Oh,
that's
so
cool.
Good.
That is cool.
So good.
So the Iron Banner stuff looked dope as hell too. The Titan with the horns coming downward. Almost like Norse Viking style. It looked really nice.
And is that Iron Banner
that we're seeing? I think so. I think that's Iron
Banner. Yeah, I can't tell between Iron Lord and Iron Banner stuff.
The Iron Lord one.
Oh, is it? Okay.
Iron Lord looks like it's made all of metal with nothing else on it.
Okay.
And then the Iron Banner has different colors and everything.
And like the woven mesh type of metal.
Yeah.
And then the Iron Banner weapons have gotten a really big redesign. Oh. And some of them, actually all of them so far that I've seen, except for the auto rifle possibly, look fantastic. And the standout to me was the sniper rifle with that big-ass spike coming out of the front of it.
Yeah.
Spear. We got to see that a few times. There's one time where this hunter is just kind of like, he kind of runs into the screen, then slides across the screen holding it. And then a little bit later, you see him like kind of perched on a ledge holding it.
Yeah.
And then you see down his scope and he snipes a warlock. I mean, that guy was like my favorite character in the whole trailer because that gun was so cool.
Yeah,
I was surprised at how good the raid gear looked in motion, because when we saw it in the Game Informer article, it was like, "What the hell is this geometric shape?"
Like,
It was really like kind of clashy looking, just like a little like, "Ugh, I don't know." And then the video, I was like, "Okay, this looks sick. I want
it." Ornaments, like the glowing light coming off.
They stepped
it up with the armor.
They really did.
This is the best looking armor we've seen so far.
Definitely. The Warlock did still look a little weird with the pyramids on the chest.
Topic-y.
Yeah, a little bit. But the Titan and the Hunter, I was like, I cannot wait to get that armor. That's going to be sick. Yeah. It does make me wonder if the shader does change the ornament, because it was like a reddish, pinkish light coming off the red gear. And I wonder if it does take cues from the shader. So, because you can put some really clashy things on there if you don't have the red shader. I'm assuming that's like a raid shader.
Forward. You know, I didn't see any chroma slots. Did you guys see any chroma slots?
No.
No, I did not.
So I wonder if that's just like a one and done thing, and then moving forward,
no,
it's just
no, there is chroma stuff going forward.
Chroma
because,
armor, right?
Okay, so one of the big things that got released this week as well was faction packages. Like, if you rank up a faction package, you can choose between weapon armor or chroma armor.
Hashtag no more boots.
Yep, no more boots.
Also, class items come at like separate, so you won't choose armor and get a cape. You'll actually get like the piece of armor and a cape.
Yep.
If you are gonna get a cape.
That's really cool. Nice. I wonder that's how really much good. It'll impact the replayability of the game, but I'm really excited about it.
Also, they're not doing it for Vanguard or Crucible, right?
No. I'm pretty sure it'll go for that. Like, why would they put in that system for like new packages and not
This is another confusing area then in the community. There's no clear evidence because they said for faction packages, you know, and that is different.
Vanguard's a faction.
Yeah, Vanguard and Crucible are factions.
They are factions. They use the exact same package system as the other factions.
Yeah, no, I get
so
that.
So
but
Iron Banner, but yeah.
See, that's the
people gonna get them some longbows.
Yeah, because I want to definitely get a weapon from Crucible and Vanguard stuff. You know, I'm hoping system is there 100%.
I'm just going to fucking call it. It's going to be there for Vanguard.
I would assume so, too.
Yeah.
The Vanguard cape is beautiful, by the way. I was wearing it when I was at Bungle.
I saw somebody using the 70... Actually, I think it was Story Machine. I saw him using the 77 Wizard, which is a year one gun that we haven't seen in the year one packages so far. I wonder if there's going to be a refresh on the year one inventory.
Maybe.
I wonder if they're going to add to it or replace it with different stuff.
They're bringing a ton of stuff back.
Yeah.
As well. And new stuff.
Huh.
Mm-hmm.
I'm happy about that. You know, more rewards to get. I think it's exciting.
Yeah.
Yep. For sure.
I also really liked that they showed a little bit of the cutscene. It wasn't enough to really... I don't feel like it was enough to spoil much. It spoiled a little bit, maybe, but I don't want to talk about what I saw in case people are super sensitive about it.
Okay, I was going to yell something. Let's not do that.
The cutscenes that they did show in that vid doc got me hyped. Like, real excited for the story.
Yeah.
Like,
I hope there's more than... We saw what could be, like, two or three different cutscenes.
Two or three pretty easily. We saw, the end of the story. We saw...
Maybe the end.
Saw some spoilers.
Definitely a spoiler, a big one.
Yeah.
We also saw some clips from the raid.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Are you guys concerned with how many spoilers? You guys concerned about how many spoilers are shown in that vidoc?
Yeah, totally. I didn't want to see that much, honestly.
Yeah.
I was shocked, actually. Yeah.
But yeah. This is the first time that they've ever shown like that much of the raid.
They don't have Luke Smith protecting it.
It was the entrance of the raid. And going through what could be partly a jumping puzzle, partly, and then also the first boss. I'm assuming it's the first boss, the Death Zamboni. Yeah. I'm like,
I feel like it's less of a boss and more of something you have to just get past.
They were shooting it though in the video.
Were they?
Yeah.
Or were they shooting the AI?
It looked like they were shooting parts of like the fire things.
Maybe
coming
you
out
have
of it.
To like stop it. I don't know. It doesn't seem like a full like boss kind of thing. Maybe just you have to
even
stop
with that giant arm coming down.
It was cool though.
Boom. It is cool.
I love the fact
and the electric
that
guitar was coming in.
In the raid. I love
that. Yeah. That was really cool.
Titans with their skating. Gonna be good. Gonna be good.
Must be Titan. Looking for one more for raid.
You see that Destin announced our raid group to Bungie?
Yep. Yeah, that was really funny. He was interviewing Deej. He's like, I'm going to be running the raid with Planet Destiny. I was like, oh. Yeah, I guess we can talk about that now, by the way. we'll be doing a little fun event with Destin Legari from IGN. We will be running the raid when it first comes out.
Yeah.
I think we're going to try to stream like us playing some raids too beforehand. Sometime.
After Destiny Community Con, right?
Yeah, after Community Con, we're going to try to get together and like maybe stream once or twice. Yep. Get everything gelling. Make sure we got good teamwork.
Gelling, like synced up. Yeah. You gelling? You gelling?
We'll be gelling. We're good.
I'm very excited about that. It's one of the hallmark experiences in Destiny. Going to a raid for the first time. Experiencing the music, the ambiance. Absolutely. It's just, there's nothing in gaming that can give you that experience right now.
The best part is just also experiencing the content blind. You're not going in with someone telling you exactly what to do. You have no you don't know what to expect from a fight.
Working it out as a team.
Yeah.
And then that's cool. An accomplishment when you finally get it done.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's huge. I think that gearing up for it is going to be, I got a feeling gearing up for it is going to be a little easier than it was last year.
Yeah.
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 It is, which is probably a good thing.
Because last time we had to go from essentially light level 170 to at least like light level 280, something like that.
I think most of us were 290
going into that raid or something like that.
Yeah, most of us were 290 going in.
290? Okay.
We
were doing okay until we got to Oryx, and then we were just like,
yeah,
gear level locked. Hard.
Yep. It's going to be a lot of fun. And I don't think it's going to be hard to get to like 380, 375. I think it's going to be relatively easy to hit in 3 days.
Yeah.
Should be good. We should be good. Plus, you know, I'm going to be picking up some 3 coins this weekend. Once I get to like that good light level, just start farming some exotics and then rank up that way too.
Nice. Yep.
Cheese the light level some.
There it is.
Yeah, there we go.
I'm down. What else is in that Bungie vid doc that you want to talk about?
What about the 3-spray sidearm? What's up with that?
Oh, yeah, the RoboCop.
That looks really good. We got some more gameplay of that today too.
Oh, really?
Where?
Yeah, it's on the Game Informer article about the PvP maps.
Okay.
And I think it's on Last Exit. They have very short videos of the Crucible maps that are coming, and there's someone using that weapon in that video. Okay. So we were able to see him kill 2 people, I think it was.
Did it look like it was hit scan? What?
I'm not sure, actually.
Right now we have a pulse-fired sidearm, and it sucks. But
Can
we just Uber Super is not...
Do you think it's going to be exotic?
Yeah.
Yeah. No, they've already stated it.
Oh, they did? They confirmed that? Yeah. Sorry, I didn't read that piece of information. Nice. Yeah. So we have another exotic sidearm coming that hopefully is not doo-doo.
Yes.
Right. Yeah.
The standard is set unbelievably low. So
yeah. True.
It's known for the challenges of can you actually get through this with this weapon.
Yeah. It looked good. From what we saw, it looked good.
It's an amazing looking weapon.
Mm-hmm. No, it looks like a competition shooting pistol, just with the grip. It's pretty cool.
That's cool.
We also got to see that pulse rifle that looks like maybe it came from the raid.
It is. It's the raid pulse.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure
the raid pulse exotic. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it'll be the raid because they talked about in the vidoc they said something about weapons from the raid and then immediately panned to that.
Yeah.
And it's definitely the exotic they told us about. So. Mm-hmm. Exotic raid.
Yeah, it looks like if you get a headshot, it shoots wolf pack rounds at surrounding enemies.
Yeah, a lot of them too. Good. Like it looks like it was like anywhere from 6 to 9 popped out of that thing.
Yeah, I was amazed. Like when they first described it, it was like a cloud of SIVA appears and hunts down enemies. It's like okay, so it's gonna be kind of like an Axion dart, right? Because that's kind of what the weapon was originally designed around. If it was designed around the Reddit version, but oh my god, it was like wolf pack swarm. Rounds. A swarm.
Yeah.
A better description. Oh my god.
That weapon looks so cool. I actually didn't even realize it was a pulse rifle when I saw the footage. I thought it was a scout. Because it fires it really fast. Thing looks so cool. I can't wait to try one of those out.
Yeah. Cool. I know what it's going to be like in PvP.
We know it has Outlaw on it.
Right.
We know that much.
Yeah.
You need to use that pulse rifle with Blade Dancer skip grenades in PvP.
Oh god.
Perfect.
You dirty.
Dirty.
God.
Liam and his boys chasing you.
What else did we saw? We saw the Nemesis Star, the
yeah,
the heavy exotic machine gun. Yeah.
Oh, and the skins, guys.
Yeah, we saw some skins on some exotics too.
That black and gold Hawk Moon.
Yes, please.
Yes.
Sign me up.
Good. That gold Monte Carlo.
Again, woo! I will think.
Looks so good. Like, my excitement level is raid and then weapon skins, because those ornaments, look badass.
Just ornaments in general, I'm just like,
yeah,
I'm so excited.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm really looking forward to that too.
So they announced that there's 22 ornaments, weapon exotic ornaments, right? Yes. And wasn't there a tweet that they officially announced or something like that?
Yeah.
So and it was that's
three
not
legendary armor.
And legendary armor, yeah.
Three legendary armor, yeah.
So we're not getting all of the exotics with ornaments, right?
No, but a lot of them.
A lot of them. I wonder which. I hope Last Word gets it.
I hope so.
I want Maida to get it too. It's never been a particularly attractive weapon.
That's true. It's not like, yeah. Yeah, that'd be nice.
I could honestly see them leaving Maida out because it's like a utilitarian type of tool. Yeah.
April 2017, they'll release more.
Yep. A new set of ornaments.
Yay. April and there will be much rejoicing for a week and a half. Do you guys want to talk about this Edge article? Because I found it really interesting.
When
I first looked at it, I was like, okay, this is just going to have repeat information from all the stuff we've heard from Game Informer. But it went a little more in depth into the development of Destiny, I found.
Yep.
It did, yeah.
You want me to just start reading them off?
Yeah, start going through the list.
All right, so this is actually a breakdown from Reddit user Mercules904.
He writes for Planet Destiny.
He put together a really good kind of breakdown of this article, so I'm just going to read them off one by one. They talk about year one problems, Destiny's tool set, desperate rewrite of the story, the struggle of adjusting from Halo to Destiny's more complex world, and Yallerhorn. The new Yallerhorn is not as powerful as it was in year one.
We can kind of confirm that. It felt exactly on the same power level as it did like after it got its first nerf, or its only nerf, really. I guess.
The tanking.
It feels fine. It feels fine. It's not god. It's not god tier anymore, but it's still really, really good.
That's good.
When we used it at Bungie.
Hmm.
Destiny 2 was meant to launch this fall, which we pretty much knew, but this seems to be an official confirmation by Bungie, and was pushed back to fall of 2017. So that's the first time we've heard a specific date for Destiny 2. Luke Smith has taken the lead for its development. Again, something we kind of knew, but now we definitely know.
Now we definitely know. And that's something I'm really happy about. The Taken King.
Yeah.
Like, did really fucking well. The raid there, everything Luke Smith has had his hands on that we've seen in Destiny has been really fucking good. So
Vault of Glass,
brilliant guy.
Yeah, if he's at the helm of Destiny 2, then you know I got good faith.
Yeah.
Rise of Iron only came into being when the decision was made to push back Destiny 2 by a year. Something they note is very out of character for Activision to allow. The ability. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, I was just saying, like, thank God Activision did, and they weren't like, no, you have to wait a year. Because the thing that people seem to forget is that Bungie can only do what Activision allows them to in terms of releasing content.
True.
They believe
so they were like, they were trying to get them to allow to release Rise of Iron. So that's interesting.
Yeah. That's very interesting. Thank God. Yeah.
It's always been interesting to me that Bungie would have... They got out of their contract with Microsoft and they slid right into one with Activision. That always seemed like it always seemed miraculous that you could get yourself extracted from Microsoft in that Halo brand. And then they slid right into another one with Activision. They always seemed like, what? Okay.
Well, maybe they weren't really looking for less control. Maybe they were looking for another paycheck, you know, to be able to fund this game.
To be able to fund. It was an expensive game. Getting Destiny going. Yeah.
They believe this was the smartest choice as opposed to releasing a game like Vanilla Destiny, which was clearly not ready.
Yeah. I mean, clearly. Good for them. They're wanting
clearly.
to.
Clearly. Lars Bakken says that issues don't always pop up when you're testing the game with 100 people, but then become apparent when the community of a couple hundred thousand gets to it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's obvious. Pretty obvious.
That's, yeah, yep. Obvious.
Skill-based matchmaking is brought up, saying the highest level players dislike being forced to play sweaty matches all the time, especially when connections are compromised. Lars replies that he understands people want to be able to choose when they have their skill tested and when to kick back and have fun, but that's difficult to do because the people at the top are having fun at the expense of the people at the bottom. They don't want the bottom ranked players to quit because they get destroyed all the time.
Yeah, and that is the
argument for skill-based matchmaking.
Yeah, that's the flip side of skill-based matchmaking, where there is some good, where a lot of people say, I can actually play the Crucible and have fun right now because I don't get matched up against a Hovi or a True Vanguard, you know?
Yeah.
You need to have that every once in a while, though, right? Like, you need to get matched against someone that's just on a completely other plane of existence from you, and then have them stomp you.
I think that if skill-based matchmaking is done right, you do. You do get matched up with every once in a while, but it's too strict, I think, right now.
I agree. I think they could let it slip a little bit, because I remember playing like FPSs for the first time, and I'd come up against people who were a lot better, and it would make me want to get better, because I'd be like, holy crap, what are they doing that I'm not doing? I want to learn how to do that. So, of course, you don't want to be in that all the time. That would just, you can't learn, you can't progress, you can't have fun if you're in that situation, but I think it's good for both parties to be able to, you know, the real skilled ones to get in and just stomp and get a 50 kill game and have fun with that. But also for the lower ones to come into contact with people who are higher and push them to want to become better players.
The
fun of the Crucible.
Right. The major problem, though, that we have in Destiny is that if you are in a higher skill bracket, it gets longer matchmaking times. And when it does match them, the connections are questionable. So it's not a true sweaty match. It's more of like somebody had the drop because they could see somebody before they could see them consistently.
Yeah.
Cotton admits that right now they haven't really made it enjoyable enough for players to have fun when they're only winning half of their games. I think this implies that for players who would normally win the majority of their games, Bungie hasn't done a good job of keeping Crucible fun when the game makes it so that you lose as much as you win. They think that private matches will help this.
Yeah. Yes and no.
Yes and no.
Understands that the community wanted it so badly that they were purposefully breaking matchmaking to make it happen. And they said it was such a poor experience for players to have to go through it that private matches were a priority.
Good.
Yeah. So I want to ask you guys actually about this. Do you think, remember we had them on, I think it was before the April update. I think it was in February.
We had them on
about private matching.
Yeah, we had them on for the Valentine's Day event.
Right? Yeah, I think it was March, actually.
Yeah.
Was it February? I thought it was March.
It was during
the event.
No, it was literally during the event, because then...
You're right. My bad.
Yeah, mm-hmm. They ended up, like, we complained about drop rates, and then they ended up giving everyone drops.
Adjusting.
Right. Yeah, I think around the board, we all came away from that discussion with the impression that they were not even thinking about doing private matches.
Yeah, it was like, it's not in the philosophy of the company right now.
Yeah.
And we're like, you sure?
So I wonder if when they started working on the private matches.
No idea.
Yeah.
No idea.
I don't know. It's just something to think about.
Yeah.
Well, we know that Rise of Iron was born from the fact that Destiny 2 has got pushed.
Right.
So,
which we think happened in January.
Okay, so sometime between January and, you know, probably June, honestly, when it was solidified.
Yeah.
Reports have previously claimed that Bungie's tools were inefficient for building Destiny. Jonty Barnes, VP of Game Development, admits that there were problems, but says they were rooted in growing from a staff of 150 to a staff of 600+, and a failure to adapt to that change. They tried to remain as a single team, and that didn't allow for the type of division of resources and attention necessary.
Yeah.
Interesting.
So they really changed the way the studio operates as they've grown. It sounds like they had some real growing pains.
They moved around like everyone's desks. They moved everything. They had a huge change up when they decided, like, hey, we actually need to separate people to have their job. Yeah, you can't have, like, everyone just work on all your stuff. It's like, we need to have this team, the PvE team, and they need to be next to, like, the investment team. And, like, they need to, they had it much better structured afterwards.
Like, the first time that I was there back in House of Wolves, the, like, the testing area was kind of down, was downstairs. And then the next time that I was there, they had already, they had, like, moved the testing area upstairs and integrated it into, like, whatever team they're supposed to be testing with. So I don't even remember what the bottom floor was or what that area in the bottom was used for again. But yeah, they've done some pretty serious changes there.
They have.
Now they have three teams. Destiny Main focused on the next major update, Destiny 2 in 2017. The Live team responsible for the persistent world in Rise of Iron. And the Engine team improved the technology that aids development.
Interesting.
This one is interesting because I don't see anything that says the next expansion team.
Right.
Or the Rise of Iron expansion.
Right.
I'm pretty sure that means Live team. So
I also don't see High Moon Studios on there. Unless they're involved in one of those teams.
What was High Moon Studios doing before?
They've never really mentioned High Moon Studios in anything. So
We know that they're working with Bungie to some extent, but we don't know exactly what. So a lot of people make assumptions to what they're doing. Some people say they're doing this, some people say they're doing that, but we don't really know.
Well, it's nice that they're getting that stuff organized. It is obviously a lot more smarter to break teams up when you're a past 100 people, because you can't keep communication up properly when it's 100. When it's 600 people, you can't just have 600 people talking to each other.
Yeah.
It doesn't work. It has to be split up, and the game has to be maintained in its current form in order to keep the population happy to then go on to these next expansions and then Destiny 2. Because, like, it's annoying when I get weaseled. I don't want to keep on getting weaseled. And they do these maintenance things. They might fix something. You know, that's all a separate team that's making sure the world is active and alive right now.
Engine team has helped by dropping last-gen support, which affected a portion of the player base that is smaller than 10% and was felt to be necessary due to graphical and memory restrictions.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Sounds about right.
I find all of this to be really article. Now, I don't have a subscription to Edge, but I'm thinking about getting one so I can read this entire article in full.
I'd get a subscription just for that awesome cover this issue.
Yeah, it is a pretty good cover.
That art is fantastic.
Yes.
There was some specific Rise of Iron info as well. Rise of Iron doesn't offer the same transformation as the Taken King, nor is it Destiny 2, merely a stopgap, albeit an effective one. Raids need to be challenging, but not too challenging, and they don't want them to be too long either. 8 hours is too much of a commitment.
Yeah, depending. I don't know.
Are we about to get another Crota's End?
I don't think it'll be Crota's End again. My guess I feel like instead of going super challenging and making it really difficult, they would maybe make it to where you can do it in different ways. Because that really seems the direction that they were going with this whole expansion, was they want you to do stuff over again, but they want it to be different each time you do it, or, you know, have different ways of doing it.
You think the raid might change?
Oh, I mean,
maybe not in a drastic way.
Well, I mean, like, that's what they were talking about for the strikes, at least.
Yeah.
In the strike that we ran, there were different pathways that opened up and closed. It didn't really change much about it, but, you know,
I'm way down for a raid that alters itself maybe per week. That'd be great. I'd love that.
Yeah. Maybe, like, a simple thing would be, like, you know, the maze section after War Priest to get the Golgoroth. That could change every week.
Or that'd be sick.
That'd be great.
That'd be cool.
Ornaments somewhere hidden in there.
There you go.
Who knows? Maybe challenge modes will actually be more challenging and not just be like, hey, here's a challenge, complete it. Because if they're going with the philosophy of not making it be 8 hours, and we've already been told that challenge mode's going to be a thing, maybe it will come earlier, maybe it will be more challenging.
Yeah.
I don't know. We'll see. But it looks fun. From what I've seen, the raid looks fun.
Cool.
House of Wolves was an outlaw story. Taken King was about revenge. Rise of Iron focuses on nostalgia and respecting the past through a rich, interesting story told by a character you've always known. Artifacts
No, that's great. Yeah.
No, that was a character all I've love always it. Known. It's like, man, I see that guy like once a month.
No, he's got that whole courtyard to himself. Know
me. You're not my dad. Artifacts are no longer just an obstacle to max light. They now change the way you play. We knew that. Guns and armor offer familiar perks, so we're not expecting a huge refresh on the perks.
I don't think we saw any new perks when we were there. The only new perks were on, like, artifacts.
A lot of the new exotic and legendary items are obtained by fixed means as opposed to RNG.
I like it.
Better?
Yeah.
Shout out to us saying it's great they have a huge, sexy Reddit community, but they don't want Reddit to be required to play the game. Does that mean an LFG coming to Destiny?
I mean, it's already there. Like they have one. Well, not in game. They have one on their website now.
Imagine a world where you didn't have to have Internet Explorer open on your computer to play Destiny, where you could manage your inventory from inside the game's UI. Manage your clan from
you can put out a beacon. Put out a beacon saying I want a raid, and then you suddenly get
5-story missions, 1 new strike, 2 remade strikes, and many, many quest lines that continue after the story. I like to hear that many, many quest lines part.
Me too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's Archons when the party starts. After the story. That's when stuff gets super great.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Archon's Forge builds on challenge of No, Court of Orcs, sorry. Skeleton key item helps to prevent people from having to grind strikes. Theoretically, we'll see how quick the drop rate is on the skeleton keys.
Right.
Max light level is 400.
Mm-hmm.
Shaders affect class items and ornaments are pretty cool. Basically, Rise of Iron is just to hold us over until Destiny 2, but there's a lot to be excited to. So again, Rise of Iron is just to hold us over until Destiny 2, so it does appear that this is going to be a year's worth of content.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
Yep.
Let's hope that live team does some amazing stuff.
Yeah. What other games are coming out? Just so I can, like, you know, see what's up.
No Man's Sky got an update today.
Oh, yeah.
It's going to take me a while to get all the armor pieces with the stats I want. So.
Yeah. Acknowledge the schedule. So they talk about the schedule. Festival of the Lost is coming in October. SRL is coming in December. That's Sparrow Racing League. Can't get too attached to plans, hence why they are hesitant to release schedules. They still have stuff left over from Destiny 1 that they want to do, but right now they're thinking about Destiny 2 and the following set of content.
I tell you, the April update is absolutely going to be all the raids coming back to normal light level. All the weapons bringing back up. I'm telling you.
They're like, use whatever you want.
I'm calling it right now.
Back up, but if the April update is all the raids coming to current light level, that would be a genius.
I think they're going to bring everything back. If they don't want to have the elementals associated with them, then there might be a different name for the weapons or like Ascended Fatebringer, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
So I'm looking forward to actually reading that entire article. I've only read this synopsis on Reddit that was expertly put together by Mercules 904.
Nice.
And
it's good. It's you know, it's bittersweet right now. It's good, and it's also like, okay, we know what we got in front of us.
Yeah.
Because we love the game. We want to play more of it. We want to just have tons of stuff to do, but we all are aware that, you know, a year is quite a long time.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yeah. And there's a lot of really cool games coming out this year. You know, Titanfall 2, people are getting beta codes for that, and from what I hear, that game is phenomenal. Battlefield 1 looks
Titanfield
really
good. Titanfall 1 was fun.
It was fun.
Wasn't enough in it, but it was great.
Yeah.
Yeah, so
Battlefield's going to be great. Yep.
Yeah, new Call of Duty, which I think the single player looks really good on. I haven't watched much of the multiplayer yet. And I don't say that about Call of Duty games. I haven't played a Call of Duty campaign since Modern Warfare 2.
Yeah, there's all kinds of stuff coming.
There is a lot of stuff coming. It's pretty exciting. Pretty exciting time. I'm really looking forward to Rise of Iron. I am hyped about it, but it does scare me that it's the only DLC we're getting for a year.
It'll take again, me a year to get like the cape I want and the, you know, armor I want on all my people.
Yeah. At the very least, we know what we got with the Taken King, what kind of timeline, what kind of stuff that they dropped for April update and all that. So we know we could probably at least expect that. The silver lining to it is that the live team apparently is making Rise of Iron.
Plus, you know? Private matches.
Yeah, private matches definitely helps a lot to have some fun things to be able to do when PvE is completely dead. Mm-hmm. But like I said, the silver lining is that they're making Rise of Iron with this live team, which means that they could make some great updates that are not what we saw in the past, but some bigger versions of stuff that is going to be great to see. Maybe new maps in PvE, maybe a new strike that they bring, you know, so. Or strikes, I should say.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
Last thing on our list is Destiny Community Con charity stream. That is a lot of words that are hard to say.
Yeah, it is. Even just Destiny Community Con is hard for me.
I usually end up saying Destiny Comic Con.
Yeah, I know. Same thing.
Didn't know
that. Last time I checked, these guys already raised like $35,000.
Yeah.
A ton right away. Yeah. Yeah,
right off the bat. Showing again how awesome this community is.
Within the first, I think, 40 minutes, they raised $14,000.
Yeah.
Holy crap.
I think Athalion was giving away steak dinners to whoever the top donators were on
his team.
You got to pay the airfare, but he'll buy the hotel and the steaks. Which is pretty
funny. Isn't their goal like 200,000?
Yeah.
Yep.
Jesus.
Yeah, they have a lofty goal.
St. Jude's Hospital.
Yep.
For cancer research.
They have a big goal, but they're doing it for, you said, 6 days? Is that what it was? Or 5 days?
It's up until the day before Destiny Con. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's a long, it's a big charity stream, but they're at 43,000 right now.
Wow.
So they're nearly 25% through the 200,000 goal, which is like huge.
Yeah. That is huge. So everybody needs to, we should probably host them after the stream. What do you guys think?
Oh yeah. Great. Sounds good.
Yeah, yeah, definitely.
And that's it. You guys want to talk about something you love?
Iron Banner, because that's going on this week.
Yeah, we did talk about Iron Banner.
There's Iron Banner. There's a shotgun. There's a hand
cannon. It's the same Iron Banner.
That's a myth. There is no hand cannon. Unconfirmed reports.
the hand cannon has a really great role this week. Rifled Barrel and Outlaw are great in combination. Plus Reactive Reload, however situational it may be, is still really good.
There you go.
Solid role from the Fender.
I did downplay in the video. Sorry, guys. It's because I normally don't do those videos, and I rushed it. So my bad.
I was working on some other videos, so I couldn't do that one. What else?
The shotgun's got a good roll on too. It's just not a very good shotgun.
Yeah, it's a good PVE shotgun. Good PVE.
Even that. You want a faster fire rate on a PVE shotgun.
Yeah, but I don't know. Have you guys played much Iron Banner this week?
Yeah,
I've played a decent amount, actually.
It's funny. I think this is the first time in a long time that all of us has actually played Iron Banner.
That Rise of Iron hype, man.
Yeah.
That track got me wanting to go in there, become an Iron Lord.
Oh, you know what? We didn't talk about the music on that video. They showed those musicians.
It's so good.
Yeah, and it's incredible. I mean, honestly, the artistry, both in visuals and in audio from Bungie, is like, it's top notch. Like, it's really difficult. Yeah, it hits you an emotional level, and it's tough to find another company that can do that level for gaming. You know,
they've been doing it since Halo 1. I remember that first time you land on a planet on Halo, and you like hear that soundtrack, and you're just like looking around. And you're like, this is different.
Yeah,
I want to buy the soundtrack as soon as it's available.
I will too. Absolutely. I bought the previous two, and I'm pretty ready for a new soundtrack, to be honest with you. The Taken King soundtrack was a little dour. A little on the depressing side.
Have you guys installed the dynamic theme yet for Rise of
Iron? No. Yeah, I need to.
Install it. It's got some Rise of Iron music in it. And if you wait about 15 seconds in, it sounds like the Halo theme starts playing.
Oh.
Really?
The Halo theme doesn't play, but the kind of monk type singing,
the monks,
the Gregorian type singing comes in, and it's like the first four notes are basically the exact same as the Halo theme, and then it changes.
Cool.
Yeah, but Iron Banner has been really good this week, thus far. I haven't played a hell of a lot over the past three Iron Banners, but I'm actually going for rank 5. I want that hand cannon this time around.
Nice.
I haven't really had any laggy games. I've had only two situations where lag has been crazy at all.
On Tuesday, I ran into consistent red bars. Okay. Yesterday, I saw far fewer, and today I didn't see any. So
yeah, I didn't see any today.
There's the way it works. It's weird.
I played 4 hours on Tuesday, 4 hours yesterday, and it's across the board. You know, it really at this point, I approach Iron Banner with the expectation of lag.
Yeah.
But now, and then if it doesn't have it, I'm surprised. I'm like, oh, nice. But if somebody just shows up and blinks, Titan blinks across the screen, I'm like, it's Iron Banner. I'd be weird if I didn't. Yeah. It's like I'm playing Destiny's PvP. How could I possibly think something else is going to happen? That being said, not all the matches were laggy, but there was a considerable amount of matches that had red bars. But I just don't really pay attention to it as much as at this point.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm having fun with it. I like Iron Banner. It's one of my favorite things because somehow that dangling carrot of loot really gets the community excited to play Iron Banner, and everybody just kind of gets together, and it makes for fun streams. It gets my clan together. Everybody just starts playing, and it's just fun to play some PvP as a group like that.
Yeah.
And now that you get so much loot, it's like winning or losing is really just not a concern anymore. So mostly we just joke around the whole time.
Yep. I could care less too on winning or losing. Most of the time the games go to there's 100 point difference or 500 point difference. You know?
Yeah. The matchmaking is spot on right now. It's it's always right on the edge of winning and losing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Every single time.
So that's Iron Banner.
Yeah. That is Iron Banner.
Same old Iron Banner. Honestly. Yeah. I can't wait to play it as Supremacy.
Next month, or you think they'll? No. Really don't think so?
I really don't think so. I really don't. And the only thing I think they might do would be I don't even know if they would do an Iron Banner and then be like, "Hey, here's Supremacy for everyone."
Yeah, that's what I could see them doing. Similar to last year, right before the Taken King, where they released the new maps for everybody for a week.
Yeah.
I could see him doing oh, it's going to be Iron Banner, it's going to be Supremacy, and you get to play on the new maps.
That would be amazing.
Yeah, it would be.
I don't know if they do it, but I could see it happening.
Yeah. I don't know, I'm pretty excited. Excited about Rise of Iron. We got to wait now. Just got to wait.
Yeah,
got to wait closer. It out.
I'm really excited. We're
32 days away?
Yeah, but it's not too long.
It'll go fast.
It's not too long to wait. But while we wait, we can always talk about Blue. Because no doubt you notice these Wildin mics and headphones that we're using. They're just some of the iconic gear that Blue creates. Blue's award-winning products are the driving force behind professional musicians, internet creators, and countless elite gaming teams and Twitch streamers. Their Yeti USB mic is the internet's most popular microphone, and their MoFi and Lola headphones deliver an insane sound and a very personalized fit. Blue offers everything you need to completely immerse yourself in the ultimate gameplay experience. Learn more about Blue at BlueMic.com.
Yeah.
Bam.
Yeah. It's seamless transitions now. I'm getting good at this.
Spot on.
Twitter questions this week, guys. It was I swear 60% of the Twitter questions were, how mad are you guys that the year 2 PlayStation exclusives aren't coming to Xbox One? So I had to call them quite a bit because I knew we were going to talk about it during the podcast anyway. Yeah. I did allow a few to sneak in, but if I feel like they're just going to make us repeat what we've already said about it, then I'm just going to skip the questions. We've already kind of talked about it.
Yeah. Yeah.
That being said, Spectre Gaming says, what is your take on PS having some exotics for 2 years? I think we've already said it, Spectre Gaming. Will Grimm says, do you think private matches will allow grimoire progression? And if so, what will prevent boosting scores?
You know what? It probably will, honestly.
In the video, on their private match, in the private build, it showed grimoire progress.
Yeah.
How many wins out of 50.
I got it, too, when we were playing. I had grimoire progress.
Yeah.
Boosting's going to happen.
It's grimoire.
What does it matter?
Is it really boosting when the number goes up and nothing happens?
No.
Yeah, boosting is when you boost for headshot kills in COD to get a skin. sense.
Yeah.
Right.
Boosting is, you know, like going into Trials of Osiris and, you know, trying to matchmake into another team that then immediately loses on purpose. Like, that's boosting.
Yeah. Yeah.
Seems to be some benefit.
I don't care if someone wants Max Grimoire that much.
Yeah, if Grimoire gave, you know, skins and stuff, then sure, we might have, you know, we might have a different opinion. But right now, mm-hmm. No. Who cares?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Dildo T. Baggins, should Destiny 2 be called Destiny's Child? Yes.
Sure. That
is a great idea. I hope Luke Smith hears that in the cosmos. I think mm-hmm. Cosmo can deliver that from the cosmos into Luke Smith's ears. That'd be great.
Louis D. Rivera, do you believe there will be auto-completion of quests just like there was for year two? Hashtag still no chaperone.
I'm not sure, actually.
I have no idea. I could see it going both ways. Sure.
Mm-hmm. I doubt it. I think the reason they did that for year one to year two were because quests really changed, especially the way you get like bounties, true. Like the Thorn Bounty or the
Super Iron Banner bounties are changing quite a lot from what we've heard.
Yeah, so. Those will probably auto-complete, right?
Yeah.
Hopefully the saving them still gets me some legendary marks.
Yeah.
Unicron, let's pretend year three is equally as dry as year two is. That's not going to be hard to pretend. What will that mean for Destiny 2's sustainability?
Private matches will help a lot.
Private matches.
I don't see how that affects Destiny 2.
Oh, he's saying how does it affect Destiny 2? Or wait, what was the
let's pretend year 3 is equally as dry as year 2. What will that mean for Destiny 2's sustainability?
For the sustainability.
Destiny 2 is going to be hype as shit. Let's just I mean that is a separate thing.
Yeah, it's a separate thing. I think maybe what he meant was how does it mean for the sustainability of Destiny until Destiny 2?
I think that you know, we'll continue to see runoff of players until Destiny 2.
Yeah.
I think there'll be a big influx of Rise of Iron players. I think that if you want that Trials gear, get in there quick.
True.
Yeah, it's going to get harder after that.
Yeah. Anthony Stewart, with the announcement of private matches and everything, do you think Rise of Iron is more comparable to Taken King now?
No.
No, it's what they said, right? Somewhere in the middle between House of Wolves, Taken King.
Yeah, it is close to Taken King.
Yeah.
But, it's not any greater, in my opinion.
What's really most concerning to me about Rise of Iron is that the aspects of long-term PvE play just don't seem to be there. It's really going to be a PvP game now.
Well,
you know?
Designing PvE content that is like lasting and substantial is unbelievably difficult.
That's why they should create a forge mode and let us do it for them.
Yes. Forge mode. And also take some procedural elements as well. Like I was talking about this on the stream last night about Diablo 3's end game now that they've got greater rifts and all that, is procedurally generated PvE content. And they've done an incredible job with that. Obviously, it's a first-person shooter, so that's more difficult to procedurally generate first-person shooter content. But still, like I feel like that's the future potential of Destiny, where they could have randomized dungeons and all that, and different loot that spawns.
That'd be cool.
Maybe. I don't know. I don't really see them doing that for some reason. I feel like any time they want you to go exploring is in, you know, some sort of world that they've, you know, created to, I don't know, to just help out with the story more by
the strike is one step toward that, where they have different paths.
They have different paths, but the overall theme of the strike has been like designed, you know, around an overarching story. If it was just maybe like have a section of a strike or something that's procedurally generated or something like that to
have a Challenge of Elders type situation.
Yeah.
Procedural.
Yeah, but they could certainly figure out a way to do it. A whole strike? No, I don't see that happening at all.
I think they need to figure out a forge mode or a horde mode. Like they just can't, they haven't seemed to figure out horde mode in this game. They tried it with Court of Orcs, they tried it with Prison Elders, Challenge of Elders, they tried again. and it just doesn't seem to
stick. They're trying
again.
They're trying again
with Archon Forge. Like, I hope they get it right with Archon Forge. I don't know if they will or not, because nothing they've tried so far seems to stick.
I think it's because they want it to be 100% in the canon of the game.
Mm-hmm.
That's like the reasoning. So if they maybe start stepping away from that, like even private matches, there's supposedly there's a canon along with the private matches, I believe. If they step away from that and allow some of these elements to just be the fact that it needs more endgame content, then they might be more successful at it. Or they might figure out both. They might be able to put it in the canon and also have all these like endgame things that are PvE that we want.
Mm-hmm.
Troy Fukutomi, sorry. Destiny lore is so expansive. Do you think they might flesh it out through books and whatnot like Halo?
Probably, yeah.
Yeah, I'd be down for that.
I would like that a lot.
Yeah.
I'd be down. Or down if they put the Grimoire in the damn game.
That would be. I would read through it in the game if it was there.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah.
Justin's OS07. Do you guys think that Year One Vanguard and Crucible weapons will still be available from packages in Rise of Iron?
Yes.
I think so.
You think they're going to just add to the inventory? You don't think they're going to replace it?
I think they're going to add. I think there will be new things added. Because...
They're going to pull out the old, though? Like, no more longbow?
I don't know. Maybe. Maybe not. I'd be okay if they, like, took it away and maybe put in some different weapons from the course of Destiny's history, maybe. I don't know.
I think they're going to put it all in.
Put it all in.
I feel like they would have told us what they're doing. Maybe by now, so we could have time to get them.
Oh, just not time to get them, because shit, it took me a year to get a sniper rifle with a good roll on it.
Yeah.
Tratorian asks, do you think private matches will pave the way for custom strike playlists at a future point?
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
Definitely, yeah.
At MikeL69, hello Planet Destiny, what are your guys' takes on Destiny finally becoming an esport?
It's not quite there yet.
It's not quite there, yeah.
What are you talking about? If you've ever seen me run a Nightfall, you'll know it's as sweaty as a sport can get.
I'm happy, it's a step in the right direction. Yeah, it's a step in the right direction.
Yeah, we're getting
able
there.
To have actual support. You know, maybe Red Bull will do something now, because when I was out there for like the Clash course, they're like, man, we were wanting to do something with PvP, but it's just impossible to matchmake. So
yeah, it'll allow companies to actually pick it up, run some stuff. So we'll see what comes of it. It's not quite there as an esport yet, but it definitely has been facilitated that it could potentially do.
It's still going to be peer to peer too, which is kind of an issue for esports.
It's peer-to-peer. They have to connect to the Destiny servers to make sure that your character is loaded properly. There's there's balance issues. Like, it's a step in the right direction, but Destiny, in my opinion, has a long way to go before it's officially an eSport.
That
starting with
said,
the netcode.
It's one of the most entertaining games to watch.
Yep.
I agree.
So I think the pickup would be pretty immediate for fans.
I think the fan base in general wants it to be an eSport. You know, like the overall vibe is that it would be so awesome for it to be an eSport. It's like, okay, now let's get these things checked off the list to make it an eSport. Private matches was the first step. Now we need some balance options in those. And then we need either LAN or dedicated servers, one of the two, to be able to, you know, fix those teleportations.
Stuart Roberts says, how much vault space is enough to last till Destiny? No. Destiny 2. I don't want Briar to have another vault outburst.
A vault break?
The number is entirely different depending on if you're asking Briar or me.
Yeah, it is. There's a lot of stuff to get in Rise of Iron. All of the new stuff, and then all of the returning, like year one, year two stuff is also coming back. I have three more pages, maybe. Two more pages.
I would take a doubling.
Doubling would be nice.
Completely fine with what we have now. We don't need any more. We're good.
You don't need any more.
Yeah.
You can't speak for we.
I'll speak for we.
You can't.
You have a problem, Briar. You have a problem. You have
I enjoy a video game where I get to collect loot that I enjoy to use. And I want you to be able to
use
loot.
But do you really
use it? I do use it. I was in the Vault of Glass last week playing with all Vault of Glass weapons.
You just sit
that was
the
fun,
shelf,
man.
And you take it down every often. You inspect it. And it's like, yep, we had good times. Or maybe we never had times.
Even if that's the case, maybe is that a bad thing having a trophy case of your past achievements? Is that a bad thing?
Back up there. I don't know. At some point when the trophy case.
I spent all this time working Vault of Glass out to get a Praetorian foil. It took me a year and 8 months to get it.
I mean,
do I want to delete it because they won't give me more vault space?
I'm just saying, at some point when that trophy case exceeds 108 places or whatever, you might consider,
I'm really talented. I got a lot of trophies. Let's move on.
You almost had it there. You almost had it there. But like
the exotic pulse rifle. Raid exotic, yes or no?
So many participation trophies.
Raid exotic, definitely.
It's a raid exotic, definitely. Yep.
JB Mega, I think that Nexus Bind will come next April in a similar style to an update like Archon Priest. What are your thoughts? Think we'll see the Nexus Bind come back in the April?
Probably.
Why
like
not?
I said, yeah. Like I said, if year two was a template, we should probably go off of it and not expect anything else for year three.
The best way to be.
You might be set yourself up for disappointment to hope for an April update.
Damn, Briar. You choking kittens right now? Man.
I got enough of them.
These
around.
Puppies can't die. Don't let them die.
I'm just saying, they haven't said there was going to be one. Grizzlies, with Saladin moving to Fellwinter Peak, what will become of his area on the tower? Door near the speaker? Ever open?
I don't know. I hope they open up that little section so we can, go chill there.
Fashion shows in there.
Yeah.
Fashion show.
I like the trees that are like the far end of Lord Saladin's section because they have like a little ring around it. And you can jump on the ring and grind on it. You start floating, and you can float around on the ring. It's something.
There's also a ghost out there, and people who join the game after Rise Iron will have access to that ghost unless those doors open.
They gotta keep them open. Open the doors. We don't like doors.
Yeah.
Keep them
open. Somehow these doors got
like an empty area though. That's weird.
It is weird.
It's just a nice. It's an area for reflection.
And fashion.
It needs something, though.
Think of all the fashion shows we can hold there. Talent shows. We have dance contests.
Maybe Eris can move her ass out there.
Yeah, she's in like a little corner in the bottom.
I feel like Eris has progressively gone to a smaller and smaller area. Like she was out on a balcony. She's like, now
she's have her ship hanging off the thing.
Yeah,
yeah, roped her ship. Yeah.
When they first moved her there, the sweeper bot was still there.
Yeah.
So she was standing there with the sweeper bot just like cleaning in front of her.
Keeping her company.
Killed the sweeper bot probably. Tired of it talking.
The sweeper bot probably got spooked out. It was like, yeesh.
Yeah,
I'm leaving.
What's with her fucking mascara? Clean that
What's
shit
with
up.
The droopy eyes? Jesus.
David Hallam, what Fender weapons and armor is a must-have before it's re-rolled for Rise of Iron?
Hawksaw.
Yeah,
Vacancy Hawksaw. From Future War Cult.
Oh, yeah, Vacancy.
Yeah. Future Rifle is pretty good from Future War Cult as well.
Oh, yeah.
Isn't that Vacancy?
Is that
That's Vacancy.
Yeah,
that's a Vacancy.
Yeah,
I always get the Vacancy and the hand cannon mixed up. So I was
me too.
The Vanity actually isn't that bad either. That's a decent hand cannon. Yeah, mm-hmm. I'm always hoping to get one with Icarus. Every time I get a package, I'm like, "Come on, Vanity with Icarus." Never happens.
Mark Gonzalez. After this past week, is that it? Is that all we got? Is those two weapons?
It's not really that great of a tower weapon thing right now. Like. No. It's like get your conspiracy theory D from the quest, get your 1,000-yard stare from the quest.
Yeah.
There's your sniper shoddy. Now get the vacancy. There's your fusion. Is Runewake any good? I never look at that.
No.
Runewake's bad.
Well, it's not bad. It's just like all the machine guns that are out there right now are just machine guns, put bullets, does stuff.
Right. Well, some of them are.
Hopefully, we get
bad
better rolls. If we get better rolls, you guys had from the dead orbit on that shotgun, that thing's going to be
Yeah.
That thing is the best.
Mark Gonzalez, after this past week and the vid doc showing, how do you feel about the amount that's been revealed?
I was a little disappointed.
Like, it's
disappointed by, like, there's not enough or too much?
Too much, yeah.
I definitely feel like I've been exposed way too much this early. Like, there's a month ago. Yeah, I want just like a poster to then goggle over.
I feel like I have like I feel like we've seen like the same amount that we saw for Taken King, but there's like less content in this one for the most part.
Yeah,
and Taken King was bigger. So, yeah, it feels like we've seen a hell of a lot more of the content.
A lot more was changing with the Taken King too.
Yeah,
like the way. So many systems worked, changed in the Taken King, and that, you know, we're not seeing those changes this time around.
Mm-hmm.
How do all four of you guys and girl plan on doing first? What do you plan on doing first in private matches?
There's so
I'm
much.
I'm first going to go open up the new maps and just explore them and look at them.
Yeah.
That's something I've always wanted to be able to do that from the beginning, and I was really surprised, as most people, being it's a AAA title, that you couldn't just load up one of those maps and walk around.
Yeah.
Like, I would do that in Call of Duty maps, I'd do that in Halo maps, just enjoy checking out the sight lines, looking at the artwork that they put into it, and it's, you know, it's impossible right now until we get those.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to be playing dumb games with viewers on Twitch.
Like, oh, definitely.
Definite.
I want to have, like, a mod tournament where each mod has, like, a team, and we do, like, no land beyond, no scope, only kills or something.
Mm-hmm. That's fine.
Like, I want to do stupid stuff.
And whoever loses gets demodded.
And the winning team, like, the whole team gets mod for, like, a day or so.
There you go.
Chaos.
I like that.
Chaos. But awesome chaos.
Custom chaos.
I personally cannot wait to actually have consistent weapon testing in the Crucible.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I can go, hey, I can get one person, we can go into a match, I can shoot him a bunch, and you can be like, hey, check it out. This is how much damage the gun does. And I can have consistent, like, I can just stay in one spot and then come in, I don't have to worry about someone else coming in and shooting me in a rumble match. I can, like, show consistent ranges now. Like, I can basically make a new weapon wall in a Crucible map and show range and then show, you know, have a Guardian standing somewhere. It's like, this is how close, you know, he has to be for range to start, you know, falling off. And he takes one step forward and it's fine. He takes one step back and it's not fine. There you go. It's great. It's going to be great.
Are you going to have tryouts for that person?
No. It's going to be who's online right now and is willing to let me shoot them a bunch.
You're not going to have a dedicated squire
in there who can't stand still. You're going to kick him and get somebody else. I know.
That's what I'm saying. You got to have
a very fashionable guardian.
Yes.
Someone who's pretty to look at.
You got to have a whole account. That's true.
That's a good point.
I've honestly thought about that. I've thought about that as well. I want someone to have an armor set that very visibly shows like the head. So like having one of the Taken armor pieces would be really great. The Warlock helm from the raid is really good because it has like that bright orb on it. The Hunter helmet from the strike that came in the April update, like all those are good. And then, you know, having a pink shader on, so you know you are very distinct from the background.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm telling you, you gotta be like, you gotta have a Twitter event being like Patrick's squire, become his squire in the Crucible.
I like it.
Be the target.
Patrick's target. Shoot him.
Mike Costanza asks, ketchup on eggs. Disgusting, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Depends.
Everyone just shut up and agree with
you.
There's a lot of ketchup in like British breakfast. Like you have the eggs and you have the bacon and you have beans.
If we're talking about different types of ketchup, we're eventually going to devolve into Tabasco sauce at some point in this.
Now, let me pitch you this idea. You got these beautiful eggs, and they're delicious. You can't wait to break into them. And there's this incredible amount of hash browns that have been cooked perfectly.
Oh, I'm loving that.
And you put ketchup all over them.
You fucking ruined it.
What?
You fucking ruined it.
Ruined it with ketchup?
You know what's good with hash browns?
Ketchup?
Hash browns. No, and some of the sunny side up eggs. You have the sunny side up eggs, and you just break them apart and put the hash browns and all the gooey yellow shit, and you eat it. It's fantastic. That's your ketchup.
Sorry, you are wrong in this one.
No, you're wrong. So
yeah,
Pikachu likes ketchup. I like ketchup. We both like ketchup.
Okay, potatoes are a ketchup delivery device.
Right. Exactly. You know, if you get some egg in there, if you get some like egg on top of that with the ketchup,
they
delicious.
Have no intrinsic value. Ask the fucking Irish. You know. I used to, every time I made an egg sandwich, I always used to put a slice of tomato on it because that was just delicious.
So unfathomably different than ketchup.
And then I got married and tomatoes became less available to me because I stopped doing my own shopping. So now I put a little sort of ketchup on to replace the tomato. And it's good.
Okay. Yeah.
Holt, you're telling me you never have any ketchup with your hash browns? Ever?
I don't put ketchup on my hash browns because I cook my hash browns so they're delicious without the fucking ketchup. You put
something about a guy who
delicious hash browns with ketchup is even more delicious. Yeah. I don't know if I can trust your culinary instincts anymore. I'm gonna have to vet every time.
Things are so far above yours that, like, you're talking about ketchup on hash browns. I'm talking about
eating ice cream with a fork.
Eating ice cream with a fork is a really valid method.
Okay. Okay.
Let's move on.
Can't move on from this, Briar.
What's that?
I don't think
we can't
it's
move
time
past.
We have to end the podcast. There's the only way. Patrick can't continue.
Edward Weaver, the new Iron Banner hand cannon RL. What's RL? And auto rifle have the Iron Banner sigil. But FR, Shoddy, and Sniper have none. Iron Lord FR. Weapons, anyone?
I'm sorry.
Maybe they just have ornaments on them? Maybe? I don't know.
It could be.
Maybe
are they better
exotic
with ketchup
Iron Banner
on
weapons?
Them?
That's what FR is.
How shitty are y'all's eggs if you're having to put ketchup
keep,
on?
Keep going, Briar. Keep going.
Also, am I the only one excited by the prospect of playing a crap ton of hide and seek? # private matches.
It's gonna be
hide
awesome.
Seek infected. Okay. It's gonna be going down.
Let me tell you something about hide and seek. You cannot play it if you're streaming unless everybody who's playing is also streaming.
That's a good point. There will be cheaters. There will be cheaters.
Yeah. The stream sniping abilities.
Eric Hansen, the new maps sure seem to emphasize shotgun play. Are we moving away from viable use of snipers in PvP?
No. And Cooch destroyed everyone. It's fine. Don't worry about it.
We need to move
just
away.
Just get good and you'll be good.
On the eggs and hash browns thing.
We're trying. K-Brad says, will current exotics get a new node for ornaments, or will you have to rely on exotic drops after launch?
Do we
That's
know
actually
it
a very
anyway?
Good question.
We don't know.
We don't know how these drop, right? We don't know how we're getting these at all.
Yeah.
Well,
I imagine
know that you
can
get them from the new Sterling Treasure replacement.
Oh, right. So they're going to be like, all right. Yeah, I just don't know if it's like suddenly you acquire it and your account unlocks that ability. You know, because obviously you can pull out any of those exotics and then apply the ornament by the looks of it. Right. And then deactivate it at the same time. So I don't know at what point do you acquire the ornament and then apply it to your account? Or
yeah, do you get a gold ornament that can go on the Monte Carlo and make it gold and it goes on the Hawk Moon and makes it black and gold? Or do you have to get a specific gold Hawkmoon ornament?
They have
a gold Monte Carlo ornament.
I fucking hope not, because my inventory space can't take that. If that's something they're gonna fucking upgrade the vault about,
really?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. No, then I'm all on board. If they're gonna put in ornaments and like each ornament is fucking different from another one, then we're gonna have issues really quick. But
no, I don't think it's gonna take up space. I don't think it's gonna take up space like that.
Vault space.
Yeah.
I'd like more space in whatever slot that's going to be in. So, like, inventory or whatever it's called.
He needs more slots for his potatoes because apparently that's all he eats. What's going to happen? Yeah, I'm pretty sure it's going to be something that is consumed and then it's locked to your account. Because when they were hovering over, it was only activate or deactivate. It wasn't like, use this item, you know? So once it's unlocked for that exotic, I'm pretty sure it's like you have that ornament then. This is what I'm guessing and what it looks like from what I've seen so far.
Maybe.
Yeah?
Maybe. Yeah, I can see that.
Because you can activate and deactivate, so it's like a one-time use. It's not going to be like a consumable that then goes away if you got like rid of it. Like Chroma? Yeah, not like Chroma, because Chroma like goes away after you've used it.
That's true.
All right, we'll have to see on this. Yeah. Hey, Brash asks, will Chroma still be a new faction armor and some weapons? If not, was Chroma overhyped when unannounced?
No, Chroma
is still going to be there.
Still going to be there.
Yep.
Also, was Chroma overhyped? Nah.
I love Chroma.
It was that much. I mean, it's cool.
Yeah.
I like Chroma. It's good.
Yeah.
It's cool.
On some piece of armor, it's really hideous. Vincent Lloyd, do you think the live team will do any new events or just keep improving on old ones we've seen already?
I think they're going to do new ones. I'm going to go out on a limb and say there's going to be new ones.
I hope to God there's new ones.
I think they're going to put a Festivus pole in the middle of the tower. In that area where Saladin just abandoned, Festivus pole.
Festivus pole. What is that?
It's Festivus from the rest of us.
Festivus from the rest of us. I don't know this reference.
You never watched Seinfeld?
I did, but I don't remember that.
My family actually did celebrate Festivus for a couple of years. It was fantastic.
Nice.
It was legitimately, we celebrated Festivus. We had a poll and everything. It was great.
Yeah, I feel left out because I love Seinfeld.
Nice. Vincent Lloyd, do you think the live team will do... Oh, I'm sorry. Drop Bear King... How are you going to challenge? Who are you going to challenge to 1v1 first?
Your mom? Mm.
Harambe.
Damn, Harambe. Yeah, I don't know. I honestly don't know.
Whoever challenges me, and I'll be like, no scope or sword only.
Yeah.
What's your cat's name again?
No scopes.
Tobias.
Tobias, you should challenge Tobias to a 1v1.
That could be fun. He could set up in the living room. We could get a private match going.
Be awesome. Be like, wait, is that you playing Tomo? Better be Tobias.
Mercs, PlayStation announced their official PlayStation 4 mouse and keyboard. How do you think this will affect Destiny PvP?
I don't know. I've never used the keyboard mouse in Destiny, so I don't know how it... It feels obviously, you know, like Dr. Lupo is very successful with it, so I don't know.
From what I understand is that it feels similar to playing on PC, but it just feels really slow because the 10 sensitivity isn't fast enough.
Yeah, that would crush me.
It still does allow you to use 10 sensitivity, which is faster than most people can play Destiny.
Right.
I don't know.
I have no experience with it.
I have no experience.
Maybe I'll buy this and test it out and see how it works.
Do you think, on a similar note, do you think Destiny is going to start approaching the potential of PC if, like, the Neo comes out and then also supports a keyboard and mouse attachment? Do you think Sony is going to say, hey, you should start supporting some of this hardware, and then they also then support a PC version?
I don't know. I really don't know if Destiny would ever come to PC. It feels like...
Doesn't currently support a PC mouse and keyboard. Yeah. You have to get an adapter to make that work.
Yeah.
Fools it.
Yeah. But now that Sony is officially releasing one.
I'm not sure if they're going to come to PC. Maybe it will, maybe it won't. I'd like to see
Destiny
it go to the PC.
Destiny 3 will be on PC. There we go.
There it is. What is that? That's like year 6 or 20. Year 5?
20 at this rate.
Hassan says, I really hate the current meta. I would take any other over this one, even the Thorn meta. What's your opinions?
Wait, Hassan? Like
San.
Oh, I thought you said Hassan, like the Twitch guy. You really hate this meta? You would take
I would not take Thorn. I'm sorry. Thorn, yeah, when someone could just tap you with Thorn and throw an arc bolt at you and you die, like, it was ridiculous. It was a ridiculous meta.
I actually like this meta. I like the meta that we currently have. the most. I think there's issues with it, don't get me wrong. But of all the metas that we've had up to this point, I did like the pulse rifle meta of early Taken King a lot, too. Maybe I actually prefer that a little bit more. Like, the pre-nerf pulse rifles were really fun because I felt like I had more opportunity to fight off sniper rifles with primary and more opportunity to kill shotgun warriors with primary than I currently do. Yeah, actually, maybe that one. But I feel like there's just more variety in the meta right now than there ever has been.
I think the reason that feeling is happening right now, and I think for a lot of people, is because we've just had this version of Destiny for a year. You know?
Right.
Just bored.
Yeah. And now it's like, I miss last summer when when Trials was fresh, you know, and but
I don't think anyone legitimately liked going into Trials and seeing Thorn final round. Who are those people?
There's people that have some serious rose colored goggles on when viewing year one. It was bad. It was not good.
You had to play around a broken perk on that final round. That's not good. That's not how the game should be.
For Trials, though, the connections did feel better. There's that. The longer we play this meta right now, the more it feels like, ugh, I wish the game felt different.
Yeah.
For a lot of people.
I feel like there was a significant design philosophy change in the way that they approach primary weapon balance. Because they've stated in the Crucible Radio in some of the Crucible Radio interviews that they want, if you're using primaries, they want the time to kills to be based on team firing. And like, that's, I don't know, I went on a big rant about this on stream earlier, but it's fine. It's fine in like, you know, if you're teaming up with people, you know, so you can actually call that out. You can coordinate it. But for a large majority of the player base, that isn't there. You're not communicating with anyone. You're just joining in.
Yeah.
So a majority of your encounters are either uncoordinated team attacks, which is uncoordinated, so blah, but or just a 1v1. And a lot of time that 1v1 is you against someone using a secondary, which is going to outclass your primary. I don't know. Maybe I don't really agree with the balance philosophies that have been put on primaries right now, where they want this really, really slow time to kill based around team shooting, because it's clearly affected secondaries. If we're always
that would be fine if like shotguns weren't as prevalent, then I'd be like, awesome, we get these like long extended gunfights, primary fights, great. But when someone could just run through you and kill you with a shotgun, I'm like,
You don't. Like, I liked the Doctrine pre-nerf because it had a fast time to kill. I felt like I could combat a shotgun warrior, right? Like, he's not going to get to me before I can spray him down with the Doctrine. That's why I like that gun so much. I think just a small increase to the average time to kill on primaries would help tremendously. And then, yeah, I really do. I think that would, just a small one, you know, like a tenth of a second. I think that makes a big difference. Underscore Rin, what is the best armor set you have seen so far from Rise of Iron?
I just want the Trials of Osiris one for my hunter. Like, I'm just in love. That cape.
It is good looking.
Kitty cat cape.
In love.
It's very nice.
That Titan with flames looks freaking really badass.
Cool, the hunter looked really cool with the flames too. And the cape on the...
Can anyone confirm if the Dead Zone Revolution cloak actually has take shaders now?
Are you asking for a friend?
You can ask.
Are you asking for a friend?
I'm asking for me.
I have no idea.
For sentimental reasons?
CG Bennett on Twitter. You know what? Let's ask him right now.
Yeah, I will. Just do it. It's Bear, right? Ask Barry?
Yes.
While you guys are doing that, Mike M., what is the biggest disappointment you have with Rise of Iron Infosplosion right now? My biggest disappointment is that there's so much info that I feel like everything is going to get spoiled.
That's mine too, man. Like, they've got the whole strike available to watch. I'm like, I don't want to see that.
Yeah.
Like, I want to...
Yeah, it's like the only new strike. I would be okay with that not being a thing that's viewable.
Yeah. All right, yeah.
Josie, since Xbox players will get Zen Meteor with Destiny 2, does that mean that we will use Destiny 1 weapons in Destiny 2?
We talked about that.
Yeah, I don't see how that really lines up, to be honest with you.
Wait, what? You don't see how it lines up? No, we talked about that.
I know we talked about it, but I don't really see how not getting Zen Meteor in year 3 means that it's going to be available in Destiny 2. Like, it doesn't... It's not a straight line for me.
For whatever reason, and maybe, I don't know, maybe I'm just thinking of this incorrectly, it feels like they care a little about the Xbox population to the point where they don't want to make it so it's like, here's some new content that is actually useless. Like, I don't feel like they would do that. But then again, maybe I am giving them too much credence for that. So, anyways, we talked about it already.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Alex, what's your guys' favorite Rise of Iron weapon we've seen so far, look-wise?
Ooh, look-wise.
I love the look of that new sidearm. The Burst Fire sidearm.
The exotic?
Yeah, that looks really cool.
Man, that
the Iron Banner rifle. Gear. I really like the way the new Iron Banner gear looks.
Mm-hmm. You know, like blades all over them, and that sniper rifle with that big ass spike sticking out the front.
Did you guys hear it fire in the Vidoc?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. It had a really poppy sound to it.
Yeah.
It wasn't like all their snipers, like a nice, you know, meaty.
Yeah, it was different. Yeah.
It felt like a have you ever heard a hockey pistol fire?
Mm-hmm.
In game. Mm-hmm. Or hand cannon fire? Yeah, it sounds exactly like that, but with like a little clunky mechanical thing behind it.
Nice. That raid pulse that's exotic looks badass. I cannot wait to use it. I'm ready for some weird looking weapon to be used.
Yeah, I'm excited.
The skinny Choctaw, with the drop of last gen, what changes / improvements do you, Destiny, would you like to see happen?
I think they're already doing it, like private matches.
We already know like a good amount.
Yeah,
of what's
like
happening.
To straight up, they're already showing that they're adding weapon skins. They're adding lots of armor. I think more so than we've ever seen in expansion. The private matches are coming. We can't see what kind of graphical updates that they might have, but there might be some texture increases and lighting, you know, differences.
Batman Ghost, do you think PvE needs a monthly event like Iron Banner? I think Bungie needs to focus on PvE more. Thoughts?
That would be cool. That would be cool. I'm hoping with challenge mode coming in sooner, maybe they could do more with it. Like, they have different challenges within the raid, not just like it's the same every on a 4-week cycle or whatever. That would be nice.
Yeah,
I'd ultra Nightfall. Like, it goes back to year one Nightfall rules, where if your fire team dies, you go out to orbit, and it's just like badass. Like, it's designed, it's personally touched and designed to be difficult as hell.
Mm-hmm.
I would love something that's just really hard, like just really difficult to do. Once a month would be great.
Yeah.
Gives you like some, I don't know, better rewards, more rewards.
Guaranteed strike specific loot, something like that.
If they offered an ornament that you could only get from those times, I would be all over that.
The blue head on fire thing.
Mm-hmm. The game really does need a timed PvE event.
Yeah,
like it's severely lacking something like that. We get Iron Banner, we get trials 4 days out of the week. It needs a monthly PvE event, just like how they had the Queen's Wrath. They had it right the first time. If they weren't going to have anything at all, they had it right with the Queen's Wrath bounties in the beginning, because it's specific loot. It's recycling some old content, but at least it's something that's brought out that says, hey, this is the only time you can get these rewards right now, or it's a monthly type of rotation. They really, really need to do that. And if they don't want to add something like the Queen's bounties in, then they need to just figure some sort of like canon into it that they can have these things.
I'd rather not have the Queen's thing, at least in that form of that event. That event was pretty. That was like a softball.
Let me ask you this thing. What's different than to Iron Banner and regular PvP?
Light level.
But honestly, like right now, really? Light level? Light is that level, really different?
Specific drops that are rewarded from it.
That's what I'm saying. Specific drops. Yeah. Specific drops.
Like, I'm just saying the Queen's, like the Queen's Wrath event was...
Specific drops. That's it.
Well, it was just really... It was literally running strikes with a modifier on it. Or not even strikes, it was running missions with a modifier on it. That was...
But that's literally what's going on with Iron Banner. It's a modifier on the same Crucible matches that we get right now. It's just different drops.
Yeah.
But PvE, PvE needs something like that. Yeah. It does. It's for specific drops once a month.
PvE.
Yeah. Needs something for sure.
Yeah.
Alex, what function settings do you guys miss for private matches? Ban and protect like COD would be nice.
What's ban and protect?
I don't know. I have no idea. I've never heard of that. I think I might have fallen away from Call of Duty before that became a thing.
I don't know what that is either.
Is ban and protect like banning items from it?
Maybe.
The thing is, if you're doing a private match with someone, you can just ban the item anyway. You can just say, hey, don't use this. One thing I'd definitely like would be able to like maybe make heavy spawn a hell of a lot more often,
Or not at all.
Yeah.
I would like to see the shields be adjustable.
Could work.
It'd be interesting.
Bamboozy, now that competitive Destiny can be more of a thing, anyone on the podcast thought about doing tournament play?
Patrick.
Watts and I, we've kind of discussed like maybe doing it.
We could dabble in it a little bit.
Dabble in it for a little bit. But I don't know if I don't know if we'll get too heavy into it. I'm too old for that shit.
Game battles is not necessarily like the most sweatiest of events. You can get in there and have fun with your friends in a competitive setting.
Yeah.
I've thought about it too. I don't know if I'll go through with it. I'm certainly not the PvP player you guys are, but I do enjoy playing PvP and I like playing competitively. So it's a fun thing to do. Game battles. Yeah. You don't have to be a professional player to do it. It's available to everybody.
And competitive play is fun. Like no matter what skill set you're in. Like just playing at that level against another organized team it's a fun thing. So
Yeah. And you'll always be playing people that are your skill level. You lose some matches and go down a little bit and win some matches, go up a little bit.
Wait, is that what game battles is? Like a ranking?
It's like a ladder system, yeah.
Oh, interesting. I didn't know that.
Spectre Gaming, if the Xbox Scorpio has better graphics than the PS Neo, will you guys do YouTube videos on the Scorpio?
No.
I probably would.
I would too. I think at that point we'd be looking at Destiny 2 anyway.
I already play on both consoles.
Consoles, to be honest with you.
Yeah, me neither. I got 6 characters at 335. Yeah.
There you go. Joshua Templeman, what's the one ornament that was shown that you are most excited about?
Trials. I get to be a beautiful pink blood fly.
Black Hawkman.
Are we talking about weapon?
Didn't it say ornaments?
Any ornament.
Oh, any ornament. The Iron Lord stuff that's on fire.
Yeah, I'm with Holtzman there. That stuff is fucking mad. Good. It looks great. Man Shark, can you have Holtzman say, "No, Mr. Bond, I expect you to die" in Varix's voice?
No, Mr. Bond, I expect you to die. Yes. Does that sound like that?
Yeah, that was
good.
Great.
Yeah, that was really good.
Nailed it.
Christopher Bond, do you think they will add a perk that affects rate of fire or impact? They already do.
Yeah, it's called Focus Fire.
Focus Fire.
Yeah.
Ryan Sheen, voting on maps for PvP? Question mark?
That'd be great.
That would be cool. Sure. It's not coming anytime soon, though.
Yeah.
I actually hate that feature in Call of Duty. It's one of the most infuriating things when you just play the same fucking Nuketown map over and over and over again, because that's everybody's favorite map. And then they add Nuketown to the game every fucking year.
Yeah. or you can...
No. My answer is no to fucking map
if, you've ever played Counter-Strike, everyone always votes for...
Yep.
Everyone votes for Dust 2. It's like, Dust 2, there you go. It's the map you play.
Nuketown!
Nuketown! Why do they keep remaking that goddamn
Why
map?
Is it always a pre-order bonus? God!
Evan Myers, how much content would you like to see put in Destiny 2 before they dip into the season pass, if there is one?
I don't think there'll be a season pass.
Yeah, I don't think
they stepped away from that.
For Destiny 2?
Yeah. I think they've like gone away from that whole model.
Yeah.
I think there's gonna be a season pass. And the reason is that their whole model for Destiny 1 got like skewed. And I think they're gonna have it figured out for Destiny 2, and they're absolutely gonna be like, here's the years of content, or this year's Destiny Pass content, and then the Destiny 2 year 2 pass content. I think that's how they're gonna structure it, because Activision definitely is looking at this with like some golden eyes.
Yeah, they're fucking up over there, Bungie. You better get it right.
Yeah, I definitely think it's coming.
They have definitely pulled on that leash hard enough, I think.
Mm-hmm. I bet they were like, okay, we'll give you Rise of Iron, but you have to give us a season pass for Destiny 2. That's Activision.
Maybe. Yeah.
Hopefully they don't say, we'll give you Destiny 2, but you have to give us weapons in
supply drops.
Jesus, no.
No! I should have waited a year.
As far as how much content I'd like to see in Destiny 2, I'd like to see like double what we saw in Destiny 1. I don't think we will, but that's what I'd like to see. I'd like to see a lot more story in the game, too. For them to figure out a way to make more PvE content on a regular basis.
That's what I want.
That's really what I want.
Yeah.
Last question. Do better. Since we are getting private matches in PvP, is it time to ask for Forge mode in PvE?
I mean, we can start asking for it for sure.
Start doing the campaign. Start it.
Yeah.
Start the campaign. Make the t-shirts. Make the banners.
Hashtag Forge mode.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I've already been asking for like a year. It hasn't worked.
Hashtag.
We've been asking.
Hashtag Forge modes out for Harambe, guys. Let's make this happen.
Don't mention that.
You're welcome,
fucking
Patrick.
Meme.
You're welcome.
Our chat. You're welcome. That word in chat on Nightbot, by the way.
I don't know why you did that either.
Because it's
why are you
hilarious.
Trying to crush dreams?
No.
Why are you trying to crush dreams?
Everyone's gonna start fucking memeing in chat, and then all of a sudden,
Forge mode out for Harambe in one word. That's not gonna get banned.
No, I banned the word Harambe from chat. Just watch.
I'm
that.
Pretty sure.
Great.
Wait, can it be attached to a word though?
Yeah.
Hashtag.
I don't know.
Yeah, I don't think
I
it's going to do.
I think we replace the A.
See, nah, it works. Okay. Forge mode for Harambe.
It does.
Told you. You can't keep the gorilla down, man.
Bye,
stop
bye
it.
Everybody.
Chat,
bye.
Sorry. There it goes.
Bye, guys.
All right.
All right, that's it for Twitter questions.
Cool.
Thanks for crushing dreams, Patrick.
No
Preach.
Fucking hate memes. So thank you, everyone, for tuning in to the podcast. That's the 84th episode. If you want to find more of me, you can tune into Holtzman on Twitch, or talk to me at Holtzman_PD on Twitter.
I'm Ryan Rabbit. You can find me on Twitter. I'm sorry, I'm reading the chat. You can find me on Twitter at TheBrianRabbit. You can find my YouTube, the Brian Rabbit channel. You can find me streaming on Twitch. Just look for Brian Rabbit.
And I'm Tefty Teft. You can talk to me at Teft on Twitter. You can catch the streams I do, twitch.tv/TeftyTeft, and also here on this channel, twitch.tv/planet_destiny. And yeah, Forge mode out for Harambe.
I'm Miss 5000 Watts. You can find me on Twitter, Twitch, and YouTube at Miss 5000 Watts. Rip chat.
Rip chat. Rip chat. Briar?
I already did my
rating and stuff.
You already did it. Did you black out? Did you black out from the Harambe talk?
Yeah, it's my brain just shut off.
Getting worse. You made it worse.
Yeah, I made it worse by
so much worse.
I know. I shouldn't have said this.
You kicked the hornet's nest, man.
Yeah, I did. I'm gonna
shouldn't have.
All right. Thank you everyone for tuning in. We'll see you next week.
Bye.
Bye, guys.